national team was celebrating World Cup glory. Today, those same heroes are fighting for a spot on this summer's Olympic team. But a slew of fresh faces are threatening to push established vets out of the picture. The countdown to Sydney begins tonight as the U.S. hosts Iceland. And the Hornets tonight, it's home for women's soccer as the U.S. national team gets ready to take on Iceland. A pleasant good evening, everyone. Welcome to Charlotte, along with Wendy Gebauer and Rob Stone. I'm John Paul Della Camera. Since April Heinrichs has taken over as head coach of the U.S. national team, there's been more of an emphasis on flank play. That means more playing time for Shannon McMillan.
Well, in last summer's World Cup, Shannon McMillan was spectacular. Every time she stepped on the field, she came off the bench. She has proven time and time again that she deserves to be in this starting lineup. It's because of plays like this. Here against Norway back in February, she nutmegs with a back heel her defender against Norway. But look at her head. It's on a swivel. She serves the ball into the box and finds the world's greatest goal scorer, Mia Hamm. Now, Mia Hamm and her teammates are going to have a lot of opportunities if McMillan and Lily get end line during this game. The leadership from Iceland is going to come out of Ásta Helgadóttir. She's in the midfield for them, and she's not unfamiliar with U.S. soil. She actually played her collegiate ball at Vanderbilt. You can see she's a good assist leader and also a very good goal scorer. She'll be the leader for them today.
Well, the last time you saw the U.S. national team, they were playing back in February in Fort Lauderdale. They lost to Norway. Since then, they've won the Algarve Cup and five straight. The starting lineups and then the kickoff next from Charlotte.
Teach sports, but some things we leave up to you.
Who will find humor in unlikely places? Will it be you? The Maxim HT-SI Plus.
Houston Camera Exchange. 5900 Richmond, that's Fountain View.
Soccer fans, get ready for great MLS action. When you order MLS ESPN Shootout, you'll get up to 100 matches you can't see anywhere else. So bring the action home. Order now. Call your cable company, DirecTV, or Dish Network.
Bud Light, proud sponsor of the U.S. women's soccer team and the 2000 Olympic Games.
Hey, Brandy, watermelons are on sale.
Clean up, you Frodo's.
Hey, Mozart.
Hi, sweetie. Elijah, I have a test tomorrow.
It's believed that learning music early can help kids do better in math and science. So the simple act of learning to carry a tune can carry a kid a long, long way. Early Notes Music Education, proudly sponsored by Texaco.
Lifting just 8 ounces a day can help keep your bones strong. Tropicana Pure Premium with calcium. The best 9.3 seconds you can possibly spend on yourself.
Today's match is brought to you by Tropicana, makers of Tropicana Season's Best and Tropicana Pure Premium. By Bud Light, official beer of the U.S. Women's National Soccer Team. By Texaco and Haviland, proud sponsors of U.S. Soccer and the 2000 U.S. Olympic Team. And by Chevrolet. Chevy, we'll be there. Welcome back to Charlotte, North Carolina. I'm Rob Stone working the sidelines tonight. It's not a goalkeeping controversy brewing in the U.S. camp, but rather a healthy competition between longtime starter Brianna Scurry and 21-year-old Carolina native Siri Mullenix. Now, the coach had determined earlier that Scurry would not play this week because she has been struggling with a quad injury. Meanwhile, Mullenix has teammates and coaches raving about her play. She's good with the ball at her feet and has demonstrated that she can perform well when all eyes are on her. JP Wendy, right now, it's a healthy competition that Mullenix is winning.
Thanks, Rob. Here's the rest of the USA lineup.
And because of an unhealthy Julie Foudy, Allie Wagner will have some big shoes to fill coming out of the attacking midfield position. And for Iceland, keep your eye on number 4 midfielder Raquel Ogman's daughter. She played her collegiate ball at University of North Carolina. She is so dangerous in the box.
She used her other name, Carvelson. That was the family name back at Carolina, so those of you may know her from that. We are underway from Charlotte. USA are in white, Iceland with a ball in blue, and immediately it's played out. Throw in for the USA, 13, Christine Lilly, in her 198th appearance. Sombrero, number 20, plays it back to Chastain, number 6. This portion of the match is being brought to you by Hamelin as the ball is played long left side. Hand took a bump there from Garter's daughter. That's a message early.
Here's a nice run by Ham. You can see she's got her head on a swivel. She just gets hammered. But you know what? That's not a good place for Iceland to give up a foul.
Ham will play it short on the restart. Christine Lilly try to send it across. That is cleared. It is a very cold night, 46 degrees Fahrenheit, and it's the first time I've ever seen the U.S. women's national team with members wearing gloves.
It is a chilly night. We're even chilly up here in this heated press box.
But no gloves for us. Goal kick on the opposite side from an 18-year-old Thora Helgadottir. April Heinrichs in the middle. United States head coach, the first coach actually to win the Algarve Cup after 5 losing efforts. They finally won one. Only gave up 1 goal.
JP, that was such a great confidence builder for this team with new coaching regime, and they came in and really decided, you know what, we're really going to make sure that we win this tournament. They went out and gave it their all, and some new players got a lot of interesting time. April was able to develop a lot of young players.
Allie Wagner pushes it back. Joy Fawcett, number 14, on the ball. Looking at the right side for Welsh, one of those new players, Christy Welsh, who had a hat trick recently for the USA.
She's actually replacing an injured Cindy Parlow, who came up with a quad pull in their last matchup against Iceland earlier this week.
That's what I thought. Milbert touched it last, and the referee's assistant concurs. Christy Welsh, 19 years old, from Massapequa Park, New York, tied for the overall lead in goal scoring last year in the NCAA Division I with Penn State. Part of that 30-person roster that April Heinrichs has just designated. Only 18 make it to the Olympics. That's 2 less than the World Cup. Right at the halfway line, it's broken up, and Chastain gets called for the foul. Helgadottir will put it back in play. Number 6 now, she'll leave it off instead for a teammate. These weather conditions more suited to Iceland, certainly. They'll play it long. Not a down in the box. Looking for a chance. It's deflected. Mullenix quick with her feet. She'll clear it out.
Rob talked about it at the beginning of the show, but Mullenix is very good with her feet. She gives her defense a lot of confidence.
This is Gudmundur Reidarsson, and he knows a little bit about goalkeeping. He used to be a national team goalkeeper for Iceland. He's the acting head coach, the actual head coach, back home for his son's confirmation. That's Olafsson. All the way back. This is Jon's daughter, number 3. Intercepted by the USA. Possession taken back. Helgadottir, number 6. 11 is Jon's daughter. To the far side, they'll play it long. Iceland looking that time for Ingeborg's daughter, and that's cleared away. It'll be an Iceland throw-in.
JP, the United States is without Carla Overbeck and Julie Foudy, both co-captains, and so Christine Lilly will be wearing the captain's armband tonight.
Loose ball near the halfway line. Welsh full speed ahead. It'll be pushed wide to the left side. Lilly holds, plays it up. They try to return it. Ham had been picked off, and Lilly couldn't get through. It'll be a USA throw-in. Mia Hamm trying to extend her goal scoring, 117 goals, more than anyone else has ever scored internationally. Lilly on that side, nowhere to go. Another throw, and this is Sobrero. Inside for Hamm. Welsh cutting, couldn't get through in the box. Played all the way back by the USA, reestablishing possession. Chastain, good switch all the way to the far side. Tough to do with this wind as well. USA's ball. Working on the possession game and a better percentage of passes going forward.
For those of you who tuned into the last TV game that we did against Norway, Heinrichs was experimenting with a 4-4-2, which is a look that we hadn't seen for some time when Coach DeChico was at the helm. But now she's actually playing a three front. We're seeing a 3-4-3, meaning three defenders, four in the midfield and three up top. So she's trying to experiment with different systems to see what's going to work best with her personnel.
It sounds like, though, the four at the back could become a staple for her. She likes that.
Right, and right now the person missing back there is Carla Overbeck. Of course, JP, she's been diagnosed with Graves' disease. It's a very controllable disease, but she has a overactive thyroid that she's getting under control and will be back as soon as she can onto the field.
She is here tonight watching. This is Milbert on the far side, still looking for her first goal this year. Leads a team with five assists. Pushed all the way to the left side. Sobrero for Lilly. Lilly looks for a give and go with Welsh, who stumbled, or with Wagner, I should say, who stumbles. Allie Wagner can't get through. Taken over. Jonsdottir. Ingeborg's daughter played it up. Good run back. Lori Fair will do a lot of the work there in the midfield.
And she's replacing Michelle Akers, who's just had shoulder surgery and actually will be out until July. So our thoughts are obviously with all these players who aren't here with the team and hoping that they're on their way to a speedy recovery.
Fawcett to the right, sneaking through. Milbert leads it. Wide right side for Welsh. By the corner flag. Should be double teamed there. Made a nice move to get free. Here comes the cross. And that one got away. Goal kick coming up for Iceland.
Well, you talk about youthful experience. Look at this. She's got two defenders on her. And look at these fancy moves right here. A little deception. The only thing that was lacking was a good cross into the box. But that will come with international experience.
She is getting the playing time. April Heinrichs trying to develop more players. And that's why the veterans haven't gotten as many minutes so far this year. Danielle Slayton actually leads this team in games started, games played, and minutes. This portion of the match is being brought to you by Bud Light. Rich Grady calls the foul. USA will have a free kick, and that one hurts. Chastain will come up to take it. Brandy right-footed it. That one's broken up. Iceland will take it back. They look to counter, but it's given away instead. Fawcett. Wide right, McMillan. Over there outside, Salmon's daughter. And that ball went out of play. Shannon McMillan finally getting the playing time. Rebounded last year, scored 8 goals after some injuries. Cost her the previous year.
She has worked her way back into the starting lineup because Coach Heinrichs likes flank midfield play. She likes play to develop out wide in the midfield.
A bouncer inside the box, headed once. The second time by Iceland, and they'll clear on a missed kick. In the air, who wants it? Hendricks' daughter. And she'll send this one up into the crowd. Wind gusting about 30 miles per hour, we're told, on the field. And this is as bundled up as you'll ever see this U.S. squad. We're in the ninth minute. It is scoreless. Very cold in Charlotte, North Carolina. It was in the 70s here yesterday. Headed up by Fawcett. Lori Fair just finished up at the University of North Carolina. To the right side it comes. Not high enough for Welsh. Brought down by Iceland. Five in the ball was Gardner's daughter. Wide on that far side. It was knocked away from Hendricks' daughter. Milbert says it's hers. Rich Grady says it isn't. Throw in for Iceland in the 10th minute. Hendricks' daughter, one of a couple players who plays in another country. She plays actually in Denmark. A couple players on this team play in Denmark, one in Norway. And as Wendy mentioned earlier, a couple played collegially in the United States. And we'll see more of that. A lot of the Iceland players have been scouted by U.S. college coaches, we're told. All the way back, this one rolls deep into Iceland's end. Let's go downstairs to Rob Stone.
Well, JP, I'm not a meteorologist, but I'll play one during this game. You were just talking about the wind down here on the field. Easily gusts of up to 30 miles per hour, but I got to tell you, it's not going to make things any easier for Iceland this half. This wind going directly into the Icelandic goalkeeper's face, so look for a lot of 45-minute pressure from the U.S.
On the plus side, Wendy, Rob's hairpiece is holding up fine.
Oh, JP.
Throw in for Christine Lilly.
Watch yourself, JP.
Get me back, I'm sure. Sobrero on the ball left side. Going long. And that one's cleared away by Iceland, who, even though they lost the other night to the U.S., 8-0, it was a scoreless game for about 37 minutes, and then they lost their defensive shape.
Well, I can tell that they've come out in more of a bunker defense, which means that they're trying to get it all, basically all but one attacking player behind the ball on defense. It makes it really tough for the United States to organize that attack.
Offside flag went up. And let's see. They've got a foul instead, and the yellow card was just given. The referee's assistant was pointing out or helping to point out the foul.
So the U.S.
first booking.
I'm sorry, JP. The U.S. will set up like a corner kick here. So keep your eye on Brandy Chastain, number 6, in the box on the backside, and Christy Welsh as well. Both of them have real good height and are very good in the air.
Gardner's daughter got that yellow. Off that free kick, it's low, and it's caught. Tora Helgadottir came up with that ball. Her first ever match was against the United States. Came in late as a sub in a 1-0 loss. She did not give up that goal. That was a game in Bethlehem. Up in the air, it's won by McMillan. Miller will chase it. Now the flag goes up.
Look here, this is it's obvious that although Ham is not involved in the play, the flag goes up, but I think probably because it looked like Milbert was going to run that ball down on the right side and make something of it. Maybe a questionable call there.
12th minute, scoreless match in Charlotte. Restart coming up. Hendricks' daughter, one of those who played in that match in Bethlehem a couple of years ago. Half of this team actually did. Up in the air, one for the moment by Fawcett. And now the USA can't clear. Allie Wagner held down. Picked up by the USA. Lilly on that left side. Allie Wagner pushing it up, trying to get the return. Wagner comes back defensively. Now it's Sobrero out of the University of Notre Dame. Mullenix. Almost found Welsh. Milbert brings it down, heads it towards space, but Welsh couldn't get there. Chastain in the air. Well, April Heinrichs wants his team to do more in the air and improve their heading. We've seen a lot of balls played in the air so far.
Well, she was very complimentary of Chastain, and that is the player in the defense who's winning a lot of the head balls, but she wants it to be consistent throughout the entire team.
Helgadottir to the left side. Hendricks' daughter, and Fawcett will play it back. Brandy Chastain will hold. Joy Fawcett again. Now Lori Fair, defensive MVP in the College Cup, the women's championship this past year. Lily gives in the middle. Allie Wagner, a star of the future, looking too long for Welsh, and it'll go back to goal. Want to see more Major League Soccer? Order ESPN MLS Shootout and pay-per-view to get up to 100 additional soccer matches that aren't on TV where you live, including playoff matches. To order, call your cable company, DirecTV, or the Dish Network. 14th minute here, and it is scoreless. Going wide. This is Mia. Back heels. Milbert to the end line for the cross, and not a good cross. Helgadottir makes an easy play.
you talk about chemistry. Look at this run by Milbert off of Ham. Has a nice touch in to try and beat her defender, but that ball's got, that serve's got to be pulled back away from the keeper.
Tiffany Milbert last year led this team in goals scored with 21. She had 14 the previous year, so she upped at 7. And some big goals, too, for the U.S. Christine Lilly left out of Wilton, Connecticut. Couple of fakes, give and go. Lilly still busting through, then she was detained by Olafstolter. Iceland tried on the counterattack, and instead it's picked up by Sobrero. And Milbert took her eye off for a second. The wind, I think, did the rest. Going for Jonsdottir, who was named the Woman Player of the Year last year in Iceland. Down that right sideline, Helgadottir, 96 Iceland Player of the Year. And that's not what she intended to do. She'll give it up for a goal kick. Mullenix gets ready to put it back in play. We mentioned before about the Algarve Cup and the fact that the USA had never won it before. It's really the next best competition after the World Cup and the Olympics. U.S. players were happy that they were able to get that win.
I think for us it was a big accomplishment because we had new players. We had, and everyone played in that tournament. And to see that we came out and won that tournament with everyone contributing in every possible way, I think it was a good push to go into the training for the Olympics that we're getting ready to do.
Off that restart, that was Christine Lilly, acting captain today with Foudy injured, and of course Overbeck out as well with injury. Nice ball from Wagner, left side, Welsh. What will she do with it? This one's blocked. It'll go out for a USA throw-in.
JP, the Algarve Cup was so successful for the United States. First time they'd won it in 6 years, like you mentioned, but it gave them a great deal of confidence going into this next period of training. They're getting ready to go to residency this next weekend, so the focus becomes very intense.
Headed inside the box, cleared away by Iceland. Sobrero tried to knot it down. Lori Fair came back to help out. She's got great speed out there. And she'll help out if they get beaten at the back, using just 3 tonight. This one goes out of play. Iceland will have the ball in the 17th minute. Throw it on that far sideline. USA defending it. Winning it was fair. Get some help on the wing. USA not reading each other as well on that far sideline. They'll still have possession on the wing. How tough is it to play when the wind is like this in the cold?
Well, you know, Rob said it's really going in the favor of the United States right now, so if they don't convert something early on, you know, obviously having the wind to your back helps a lot, but trying to attack into a wind like this is really, really tough. You basically feel like you got a player on your back.
Iceland can't move it up the middle. Now they can with Gardarsdottir. Chastain comes back. Fawcett feeling the pressure. Fawcett did well to release that ball and just get it out of danger. It's rolling all the way back towards the corner flag in Iceland's end, and it'll eventually roll out. And after all that, the ball belongs to Iceland. What's your early read, Wendy, so far after 17 minutes?
Well, when we talked to April earlier today, you know, JP, she's really trying to get a lot of precision in her attacking out of the width in the midfield. And I still think the U.S. is, you know, simply because they've been playing this other system where they were getting width up top, they're kind of, you know, just by nature or by habit, their forwards are getting high instead of leaving that flank area for the midfielders. And I think what they need to do is continue to change the point of the attack through the central spot, but get it out wide to Lilly and McMillan, and they'll be dangerous.
Ogmundsdottir with that penetrating ball. It was intended for Helgadottir. Ogmundsdottir runs it down far side. She looked across. It was knocked away by the USA. Iceland's ball deep with a throw-in. From the far side, USA pressures the ball. Now it's cleared by Chastain. And finally sent up towards the halfway line. Noble is up there with Welsh. And Rich Grady stops play again on that foul. Christy Welsh, listed at 5'10", only playing in her 8th international, but she scored 5 goals. She's the leading goal scorer in this team this year.
That's amazing. That's a great statistic for her to start the year off with. And she is young, and she's got a lot to learn about the system. But she's a phenomenal player. Anybody that got to see the Final Four for the women's collegiate tournament, she was fantastic for Penn State. She's very, very dangerous. When she gets the ball down at her feet and she's got space to attack, reminds me a lot of Danielle Fotopoulos.
Fotopoulos, one of five players right now, not a part of this national team from the last World Cup. Rich Grady gives the ball back to the USA. It was out of play, so it'll be a throw-in for McMillan. And just given away. Right back it goes to Iceland, Jonsdottir. Chastain trying to bring it down. Tough to read some of these balls that are hanging up in the air as long as they are. Lily from Sobrero. Christine Lilly with 20 goals last year. Her previous best was 12. Going wide right side, USA. Mia Hamm this time shows up in the right wing. Leaves it off towards the right corner. The run to the end line. Then the cross. Helga Dorter did well to stop that ball from getting through.
This was a great opportunity here to create a 2v1 by the United States. Executed brilliantly, but McMillan did have a lot of pressure. She didn't have a lot of time to get that serve off. But if she did, she had two players on the backside. If she could have gotten a little more on it, lifted it backside, that would have been a great scoring chance for the United States.
This portion of the match is being brought to you by Chevrolet as the USA goes forward. Into the box, you've got Hamm. And Welsh, it could have been an own goal. It was off the crossbar. Well, that's as close as we've come to a goal so far tonight after nearly 21 minutes, and it would have been an own goal. McMillan taking on a defender or two. Goes wider to the right. Mia Hamm to the end line. Here's the cross for Welsh, too high, and put over by Lilly.
And that's the ball I was referring to previously, if McMillan had gotten it back post. A lot of times the defense has numbers, tons of numbers near post. So we'll take a look here. This is a great through ball here. Look at this back heel by McMillan, and then another quick ball to Mia Hamm. She gets in behind the defense. This is great right here. Now she looks up, and that's, I'm sorry, that was the previous play, but that was a good opportunity there for Welsh in the box.
Jonsdottir almost knocked it into her own goal. This is Helga Dotter, the younger sister of the team captain. Chastain in the air, gets some help. And now it's Lilly again, taking it over. 13 years for Christine Lilly with the national team. Sobrero to Wagner. Welsh on the turn. Lilly follows up, goes wider. Here's Milbert on the outside. And Milbert tried to cut that ball back across and miskicks it. It goes out for a goal kick. Tiffany Milbert. Twice now in the last 5 years has been the leading goal scorer on this team. And it helped take some of the pressure off of Mia Hamm. They've worked so well together.
I mean, and both of those players, Tiffany Milbert, you mark her up, you know, if you give Hamm any room, they're so dangerous. And then not to mention some of the other players who aren't even on the field due to injury, like Cindy Parlow, for instance. It's just frightening how dangerous this front line can be.
This one goes out of play. It is Iceland's ball. And with that, we'll go downstairs once more to Rob Stone.
U.S. bench very pleased with the play the last couple minutes. And something that April Heinrichs talked to us earlier today about is more flank play and trying to get it down to the end line. And, Wendy, that's really where they're killing Iceland the last couple minutes.
Rob, you're right. Because when they do get it wide, you've seen their attacks develop by 2v1s. And, you know, great flank play by, like, McMillan and Hamm, for instance, to get the ball. A nice serve off of the end line into the box. They just need to tighten up just a little bit on the service selection into the box.
Iceland will have the ball. So far, they've done a pretty good job defensively, shape-wise. Last few minutes, it's been breaking down a bit. But you got to remember, this Iceland team really haven't played. They played Wednesday night, their first game since October. Their league ends in September. They played some national team games in October. That's been it. And the weather's been so bad there, they can't even train outdoors much. Them will take it away, and here they come. Put in a space. Chastain runs it down. The three at the back so far has been successful. They haven't been burnt on it so far.
Well, they haven't been under too much pressure yet either, JP, because Iceland is playing with either one, definitely one player pushed up high, and that's Ogman's daughter, or Kravelsen, who you mentioned earlier. Raquel, she's up high. But they really haven't had a lot of pressure on them defensively.
And that may come yet. Maybe when they change ends and the wind goes with them, we'll see. On ESPN's More at 5 p.m. Eastern, 2 p.m. Pacific, join Cliff Drysdale, Patrick McEnroe, and Pam Shriver for the 2000 Davis Cup quarterfinal matchup. The U.S. team led by Captain John McEnroe will go head-to-head against the Czech Republic as this one is caught by Helga Dodder. Surprisingly, in that Davis Cup, the Czech Republic won today. They're up 2-1. Foul on Sobrero at the other end. Iceland will be putting it back in play. Their best hope, obviously, a low-scoring game, defense first. They have no chance in a high-scoring game. Sent long. Ola's daughter's pass cleared away. Welsh to Lilly. And Lilly will push it back. 83 career goals for Christine Lilly, up among the leaders now. Not just with this team, but all U.S., all international women. Here's Lori Fair, switching it right. Into the box, Milbert. Milbert heads it wide, but you could count about five blue shirts around her when that ball was played through.
We've mentioned a bunker defense. This is a great look at it here. Look at this nice early ball in by McMillan. But Milbert, she does. She has three players around her. That's going to be a really, really tough ball to finish. It's a good ball. It's lofted in there. Maybe if it was more driven, Milbert could have gotten a quick flick off of her head, maybe to the far post. But that's a tough ball to finish. I still think they got to find ways to go wide.
Sobrero will chase it back and leave it for Brandi Chastain. Wagner. Right side for Joy Fawcett. If anything, it's getting colder here tonight, and the wind, you can hear it, it's picking up. This one's cleared out of play. Another throw-in coming up for the USA national team. Winners of five straight after a slow start to this year, losing two games to Norway. This is as bundled up as you've ever seen a USA crowd. They came prepared. 27th minute. This one remains scoreless. USA has had much of the possession, the scoring chances, but nothing yet to show for it. Flick inside the box. Welsh, nice foot save. That's simply reflex from Helga Dodder. It's a corner kick.
And we've seen that at least three times today. She is playing a great game in the nets for Iceland.
And that's got her all charged up. This is her ninth international match. Second against the U.S., or third, I should say, after Wednesday. It's coming across Chastain, and Helga Dodder was there. Good movement off her line for the 5'9 goalkeeper.
This is a tough ball for Chastain. She just does everything she can to try and keep it back in play and pull it out away from the keeper, but from that angle, that's really tough.
Back live, Sobrero to the feet of Mullenix. So far, the USA with all the shots in this one. This portion of the match is being brought to you by Allstate. We're in the 28th minute. It remains scoreless. Helga Dodder with a couple of good saves at the other end. Mullenix yet to be tested.
Well, typically when a team gets beat like Iceland did in their last matchup earlier this week, pretty handedly by the United States. You're going to see them come out in their second game, especially for a televised match. They got a lot of pride on the line in a bunker defense. And this is exactly what Coach Heinrichs wanted to see, because that's a great challenge for her team. The reserves broke it down very well in Denmark, against Denmark in Portugal. And so she was really interested in seeing whether or not the starters could break it down today.
That's the only way you could beat a bunker, is to train against it. So this is a pretty good test for the USA. Hendricks' daughter plays for the club side Frederiksberg in Denmark. Will play it on the free kick off the left foot. Lori Fair headed it up. Tiffany Milbert from the University of Portland putting it into another gear. There was some speed shown there. Possession maintained back to Lori Fair. It'll be switched. That ball died in the wind. Lily couple of fakes, couple more. On the right foot, a shot though right at the goalkeeper. Sometimes people forget that Lily is so strong with the left foot that her right foot's not so bad.
She's trying to post this player up, and she's got a runner going wide with Wagner there, but she can see that the defense has read it. So she sets up her right foot and has a nice, powerful shot, but I think actually the wind looked like it bent it right into the keeper.
30th minute, scoreless from Charlotte. From the right side, Shannon McMillan lifts it. Welsh flicks it to Milbert. Two defenders chase her. Milbert at the edge of the box, try to cut it back. No one made the supporting run for her. And that one's going to be cleared out. Another throw in, USA. And Wednesday, they didn't score until the 37th minute. We're in the 30th now. Then they opened it up with six goals in the second half. Sobrero. Lily has to wait for this. A driven ball inside, and that almost made it. But Lily showed the vision and the skill to get that ball there. Welsh was the intended target.
Well, they're trying to mix their attacks up here. This was started by Sobrero, trying to get it out wide to Lily. Lily looks up. She doesn't have a way to get it out wide farther. She looks for a quick, easy ball in. But my guess is that the wind caught a hold of that thing, because usually Lily is so precise on her serves. That was a great opportunity.
Left sideline, Hendricks' daughter on the wing. Picked off by Shannon McMillan, who, like Milbert, also had a stint playing in Japan in a pro league there years back. That was a dangerous ball, but Sobrero is back. That was the one time where the defense nearly broke down. Mullenix gave it away, and that is her strength, her foot skills. And, you know, she hasn't hardly touched the ball in the first half. She's lucky she got that ball back.
We should have Raquel Ogman's daughter coming at her, and they're very familiar with each other playing together at University of North Carolina, and she knows how dangerous she is. So if Raquel had taken that ball down, who would have known? Who knows? She probably would have gotten a nice scoring chance.
Yeah, regardless of what she did in the last play, she's supposed to have the best foot skills of any of the goalkeepers
in
this camp.
She does, right-footed and left-footed. But, you know, when a keeper doesn't touch the ball very much in the game, their first couple touches can be kind of jitterish.
Switch by Fair. McMillan has come back, now crosses the halfway line for Welsh. Comes back to Fawcett. Joy Fawcett trying to put it through. Mia Hamm undetected on that run at the end line. And that's knocked out, corner kick. Second one, that's it for the United States. Usually they have more at this stage. Shannon McMillan. Remember the corner kicks from the World Cup. That one was up a bit too high. Intended for Chastain. Strong in the air going forward. And then corner kicks, that's where they miss players like Michelle Akers.
And look at Chastain having some words with the referee. She felt like she got bumped off that ball, which I have to agree with from this angle up here.
Helga Dotter. Ugman's daughter. Blocked by the USA. Wagner, good ball. Milbert running forward. Milbert shot, save. Helga Dotter, that's got to be her best. Even better than a foot save.
There's a nice win by McMillan into the midfield here. And look at Tiffany Milbert's explosion. Holy cow. And Helga Dotter comes out very, very strong. Again, the ball was won here by the United States in the midfield. Great through ball. And the explosion is legendary. But Helga Dotter's having the game of her life. She is so confident back there in the net.
Against the defending World Cup champions. Iceland has come here to learn and gain experience. And they've got to like that so far. This is the player of the match so far. With four saves tonight, couple spectacular. Tora Helgadottir, who won't turn 19 until May. She gets ready to put it back in play. Still scoreless, thanks to her. 34th minute. Chastain in the air. Lori Fair. And now Iceland will try the long ball approach. Mullenix came out a tad late. Almost paid a price. McMillan up the wing. And that's taken over. Iceland have it. And then it's lost. Chastain finds the open player. McMillan tried to find Ham in the wing. USA will get a throw-in out of it. This portion of the match has been brought to you by York Peppermint Patty. 35th minute. Score.
Sounds good right now, doesn't it?
York, yeah. A little energy boost. Throw-in coming up on that far side. It belongs to Iceland. Well, if you get good goalkeeping, and this coach, we told you before, Gudmundur Ryderson used to be a national team goalkeeper. You'll always have a chance if you get good goalkeeping, even against the World Cup champions. Logi Olafsson is the real head coach for Iceland. And as we told you before, he went back to his native country for his son's confirmation. Wagner will switch it across. USA trying to break down this Iceland defense. Seaman's daughter let it go out. I think she thought it was going to be her ball. Quick throw in for the U.S. Milbert did well. It's cut off. Now it's Allie Wagner. Nice move inside to Milbert. The turnaround. She didn't have enough on it. I think that time she would have beaten Helga Dota.
Wagner trying to buy some time, but there's a lot of bodies in the box. There's a miss clear, and that's a great half chance by Milbert. That really shows her experience in the box.
Join us at ESPN2 next week for the 2000 Barcelona Championships. Defending champion Monica Seles will look to repeat her success against some of the biggest names in women's tennis. Coverage begins on ESPN Friday, April 14th at 2 p.m. Eastern, 11 a.m. Pacific time. Christine Lilly on the ball. Four defenders around her, and Iceland will win it. Chastain comes back to defend. Fawcett takes it over. Right side, McMillan. That one's knocked away. McMillan will chase it out. USA's ball. McMillan wants the quick throw in for Ham. She was tied up. Foul is called. Free kick coming up for the United States. Simmons' daughter playing in her third international commits that foul. One of two players with children on this team for Iceland. Minute, free kick. Kept low. Ham tried to turn inside, couldn't do it. Another USA throw-in. Ham looks, Milbert comes after it, showing for the ball. Knocked away by Iceland, again it's a throw-in. Again it's McMillan. The turn inside. They try to find Wagner, instead it's coming back. Iceland with two on the attack, but they're going up against three here. Nobody supporting the run, but they lost their defensive shape to the USA there. About four players were together. It's still scoreless thanks to the goalkeeping of Helga Dóttir for Iceland.
Well, all game long we've been talking about her. She's just been phenomenal in the nets, playing with so much confidence.
Lilly leads it. Milbert inside. Helga Dóttir came out late. That was almost handled. It was handled. Handball on Mia Hamm.
Here's another look here at Milbert's. Whoa, nice shove there by the defender, but ref plays it on. Nice ball back away from the keeper, and Hamm just gets tangled up with her defender there. That was a really nice defensive organization there by Seaman's daughter.
Mia Hamm will chase this ball down on the wing, and that was a tough landing. Mia Hamm is down. And right now, not moving. You can hear a pin drop right now in this stadium.
Well, Ham's trying to chase this ball down here. Oh, yes, she got her toe hooked up in the turf and hit her head on the signboard there.
Well, they're tending to Mia Hamm right now as the hush has pretty much come over the stadium. It looked rather easy, but as you see in the replay there, that's how she hit it. It looked harmless at first. Let's listen in as we play this back for you. We're laying out. Man, that's scary.
She might be knocked out there for a while.
I thought she was out.
You can tell she just got her toe caught up in the turf there as she was trying to play that ball.
They've given a yellow card to Hendricks' daughter. And let's see why.
Yeah, she takes McMillan down after the play.
That had nothing to do with a ham situation. So that's the second yellow card issued today. This is Hendricks' daughter. And they're still tending to Mia Hamm. Again, it looked harmless. You could tell that she knew where she was. It looked like she had a chance to look up, but that stumble obviously cost her. And when I first heard the sound of it, I thought it was her foot that hit the boards, but it wasn't.
Yeah, she didn't have any chance to get her hands down to brace herself for the fall.
So the all-time leading goal scorer, woman or man, in the history of this game is down.
Back off a little bit.
And right now they've yet to restart the game. We will get a report on Mia Hamm as quickly as we possibly can. You'll know it when we do. And it's good she's at least conscious because she did look like she was out. Meanwhile, play has resumed. We'll get an update for you. Joy Fawcett to the right. USA playing with 10 now. That looked like a handball from here. Not called. Cleared out. Chastain will pick it up. Brandi Chastain with a couple of cuts. And more. Broken up. Iceland trying to come back here. 41st minute. The game has lost somewhat of its importance, though, with Mia Hamm down. And hopefully she's okay. Throw-in coming up for the USA. Joy Fawcett on that far side.
Well, remember, the United States is playing a man down right now, so they need to play good possession ball.
Lily. Oh, she got nicked as soon as she played that ball. Here's Wagner on the left side. Looking long inside, and it's right to the goalkeeper, Helgadóttir. What's going on in a situation like this? You've been there before, either you being injured or a teammate.
Well, I mean, first of all, the trainers are trying to just make sure that she's okay. It looked like they were looking at her shoulder as well as, you know, she's probably got a big lump on her head. As we mentioned, she didn't have a chance to get her hands down to support the fall, and running into those sideboards is just like hitting a wall.
Let's go downstairs to Rob Stone.
Well, you see Mia Hamm is getting up right now. Obviously, just a little bit woozy. They're testing her for feeling in her hands, checking her neck and her eyes, having her rotate her head. Wendy, JP, you guys know as well as I do, Mia Hamm is one heck of a competitor, and she is ready to start onto this field as soon as she can.
Rob, not to put you in the spot, but do you think she lost consciousness, too, from where you were?
From where I was, there's no way I could tell right now, JP.
Okay, thanks, Rob. We'll get an update as well, a further update, maybe, by halftime. But Mia has gotten the referee's permission. You can tell by the roar of the crowd, she is back, and we'll see how she goes. And they'll really watch her. They will not take chances. And they'll check her again, I'm sure, at halftime. Here's Milbert, touching it off to the right side. McMillan runs into trouble. Iceland will clear. Iceland would love to go into the locker room at halftime, 0-0. For the USA, a different story. Chastain, not enough on that ball. But luckily, it goes to Sobrero. The defender wasn't putting in enough pressure. Ogman's daughter. Sobrero to the left. Kate Sobrero left puts it ahead. Milbritt and then Welsh, and they may have confused one another on that. The goal kick coming up. And also coming out, the All-State Halftime Report. Rob Stone will bring us up to date on all the U.S. soccer news, including an update on Michelle Akers. And then Wendy and I will review first half highlights. And it might be a goalkeeper package, and not the USA goalkeeper, but the Iceland goalkeeper, Helgadóttir. She's been brilliant tonight. So far, from what we've got, 6 of the 7 U.S. shots have been on goal. 6 saves for her and some brilliant ones. Off that throw-in from Ogman's daughter. She fights to get it back. Sobrero is over there in the wing. That's won by Iceland. Jónsdóttir sends it long. Fawcett, the ball, seemed to handcuff her. It was up there so long in the wind.
Well, JP, last game, Iceland felt like they hung in there for about 30 minutes. They've hung in here this whole half and have done a very good job to take, you know, basically take the U.S. game away from them. They've created a lot of problems with this bunker defense that they're playing.
McMillan to the right. This one's blocked. Turned all the way back. Lori Fair pushing up. Leads it wide. Mia in line. Try to cross it. She'll get a corner out of it. Third USA corner kick, which might be a low for them in a half.
Well, Iceland has done a good job to not to give up any useless corners. They've done a good job to get the ball over the sideline as opposed to giving up corner kicks.
Mia Hamm drove it across. Misplayed by the defense. It nearly cost them. Helga Dotter, she did well there not to give up a corner kick. A couple of minutes of stoppage time will be put on because of the Mia Hamm injury. This one's going to be cleared. Hamm has since come back, though, and appears to be okay. We might get a further update if we can at halftime. Throw-in coming up for the United States.
In all the games we've done, we've never seen somebody hit the boards like that.
Not like that.
Typically, they'll get shoved or there'll be a dangerous foul over by the sidelines, but it's good to see her up and on her feet. She's one of these players, you could tell the hush of the crowd. Even up here, we were just wondering whether she was going to be okay. She's done so much for the sport and women's sports in general. Just an amazing pioneer and incredible woman.
Welsh can't get through. Full credit to this Iceland team. They were pounded 8-0 Wednesday. Here they are coming back, playing much better defense, much better shape. But the goalkeeper has saved them too, you got to say that. Otherwise, we might be talking different. It could be a 4-0 game.
Definitely. She has saved four what we thought were certain goals from up here. Just has had a great game. Great first half so far.
Welsh. That's a little bit more than shoulder to shoulder, says Rich Grady on Jonsdottir. Christine Lilly. Quick restart. Mia Hamm waits for the rolling ball. Plays it across. Settled and chipped up there too far, too high by Welsh. We're in the second minute of stoppage time. And Helga Dotter should take her time here. A moral boost, certainly, for this team if they can go into the locker room 0-0.
No question. They've had the wind coming at them the whole first half. That's going to help them in the second half develop their attacks. They'll have the wind to their back in the second half. Iceland will.
Knotted away to the right side. Fair left it off. That might be it. Rich Grady blows the whistle. This first half comes to a close. Welcome to the Helga Dotter Show. She's been brilliant.
Oh, she has. She's been so fantastic. She's giving her team a lot of confidence.
Let's go downstairs. We've got Rob Stone.
Going out by Mia Hamm. Mia, how you feeling?
Okay. Just tell my mom it's not as bad as it was.
What happened on the play?
Oh, I don't even remember. I was trying to keep the ball in bounds, and then I was eating some sideline boards, so maybe I can use some pull and move them back a little bit.
We'll probably put some pull for you. Mia, thanks for your time. Feel better. When we return, it's the All-State Halftime Report with an injury update on Michelle Akers.
Wanted one person to watch televised sports all day.
Job includes playing video games and receiving massages.
Salary $100,000 to $150,000.
Cavalier, so dependable there are more of them out there working than any other small car.
Okay, come on, who's your dad?
Cavalier, we'll be there.
One in four women teaches. One in four takes the road less traveled. And one in four women is born with genes that make her sweat more than others. Secret Platinum Protection, the strongest form of antiperspirant you can get without a prescription. pH-balanced Secret Platinum Protection.
All
Allstate joins every sports fan in America in cheering the team that has beaten the world at its own game. This year, they know we're coming.
When you get to your sinus pain before it gets to you with Motrin Sinus Headache, statistics show high notes sound 20% sweeter, spins are 40% more pleasurable, and being married feels a lot more like dating. Motrin Sinus Headache has a powerful decongestant, so you can put the pain to bed while you stay out all night. Motrin Sinus Headache. Life is too good to feel bad.
Hey, grab me a Bud Light.
Oh, no!
Would you look at that?
Oh, it's on the left!
Really?
Sorry, buddy.
What are you doing?
Y'all done?
Oh, yeah.
With a great taste that won't fill you up and never let you down.
I've got an idea.
Make it a Bud Light.
15 years ago, I gave John his start. I ordered the first Papa John's pizza.
No, it was me.
I said, John, this pizza's got great stuff on it.
Join our celebration. Get two large one-topping Papa John's pizzas for just $12.99.
Get it straight. It was me.
I said, this sauce is special.
Me, 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 me.
Hey, wasn't it you that ordered the first pizza?
Well, I am your mom.
Get two large one-topping Papa John's pizzas for only $12.99. It's our way of thanking all our loyal customers.
Today's match is brought to you by Secret Platinum Protection. When it comes to antiperspirant, nothing is stronger. Secret, proud sponsor of the U.S. Women's National Team. By York Peppermint Patties, dark chocolate, cool mint, get the sensation. And by Bud Light, official beer of the U.S. Women's National Soccer Team.
Welcome back to Charlotte, North Carolina. At the break, believe it or not, the U.S. and Iceland deadlocked at zeros. Welcome back to the Allstate Halftime Report. I'm Rob Stone. We begin our tour around the U.S. soccer world with an injury update on Michelle Akers. The 34-year-old vet underwent successful shoulder surgery on Wednesday to repair some damage from a dislocation to her right shoulder. Akers will be out up to 3 months, returning in July, giving her 2.5 months of prep time prior to this summer's Olympic Games. Akers will miss the next televised U.S. game. It's the final of the U.S. Women's Cup, live from Portland, Oregon, Sunday, May 7th, only on ESPN2. On the men's Olympic front, head coach Clive Charles announced his 18-player Olympic qualification roster yesterday, and it is highlighted by DC United midfielder Ben Olsen and Ajax's John O'Brien. A couple teenagers making the roster as well. You know them well in MLS. DeMarcus Beasley of the Chicago Fire and Landon Donovan of Bayer Leverkusen. Those teams, the U.S. will compete with five other sides for just two Olympic berths beginning April 21st in Hershey, Pennsylvania. The States will be in a group with Canada and a team yet to be determined. The two sides that advance to the April 30th championship match automatically qualify for the Sydney Games. And that'll wrap up the U.S. Soccer Report, but we will have plenty more when the Allstate Halftime Report continues after this break.
Some guys look so good in a Suit Mart designer suit, they never want to take it off. And right now, we've got thousands of twofer specials.
Thousands of famous maker shoes.
Get two for $72.
Thousands of important suits.
Get two for $150.
Because if you want twofers,
then you want Suit Mart.
Suit Mart, four locations, open every day till Easter.
Everyone, there are birds in the bird bath.
I can't see.
Excuse me, but I think you need a room with a view. Enjoy the outdoors by calling Rooms with a View. Compare and save 50% on the nation's finest solariums and sunrooms with payments as low as $98 a month. Call now for a limited time. Every room gets free Berber carpet. Rooms with a View. For a free estimate, call 1-800-522-2171.
Baseball's ultimate road trip stops in Tampa for a showdown with a lot of pop. Jose leads the Devil Rays against Manny and the Tribe. The ultimate road trip rolls on with Sunday Night Baseball. Indians Devil Rays, tomorrow at 8 on ESPN.
How does the almond get into Hershey's Kisses with almonds?
Ice!
Little Hershey's Kisses with almonds. Good chocolate taste.
Magnetic Springs, the perfect place to test our new magnetic insoles.
My feet ache like the devil.
Our Dr. Scholl's Magna Energy insoles can help.
Each insole has a powerful magnet system inside.
Really cool.
We believe in magnets around here.
Are you one with the magnet?
Feels good.
Treat yourself right at drscholl's.com.
What's this stuff?
Some cereal. It's supposed to be good for you.
Did you try it?
I'm not going to try it. You try it.
I'm not going to try it.
Let's get Mikey.
Yeah.
He won't eat it. He hates everything.
He likes it. Hey, Mikey.
Wholesome whole grain oats, lightly sweetened. No one ever outgrows the terrific taste of Life cereal. No wonder Mikey's of all ages like it.
I like it.
After 6 weeks, how does the Dr. Scholl's Dynastep Sport Insert feel?
Before I tried the inserts, I had shin splint pain. Now I don't.
It's clinically proven among athletes to provide immediate relief from lower body pain.
When I play basketball, my lower back is much, much better.
Treat yourself right at drscholl's.com.
Hey, is that a Kit Kat bar?
Can we have a piece?
Sure.
That is not a misprint. At the break, Iceland and the U.S. Women's National Team tied at zeros. When we return to Charlotte, North Carolina, JP and Wendy will break down the first half. This is the All-State Halftime Report.
Joins every sports fan in America in cheering the team that has beaten the world at its own game. This year, they know we're coming.
When you get to your sinus pain before it gets to you with Motrin Sinus Headache, statistics show high notes sound 20% sweeter, spins are 40% more pleasurable, and being married feels a lot more like dating. Motrin Sinus Headache has a powerful decongestant, so you can put the pain to bed while you stay out all night. Motrin Sinus Headache. Life is too good to feel bad.
Magnetic Springs, the perfect place to test our new magnetic insoles.
My feet ache like the devil.
Our Dr. Scholl's Magna Energy insoles can help.
Each insole has a powerful magnet system inside.
Really cool.
We believe in magnets around here.
Are you one with the magnet?
Feels good.
Treat yourself right at drscholl's.com.
Good morning, Mr. Clark.
Morning, Tommy.
Good morning, Mr. Clark.
Morning, Tommy.
Good morning, Mr. Clark.
Morning, Tommy.
Amazing. That car never ages.
To help keep your car young, protect your engine with Havoline Formula 3 motor oil. Add more life to your car.
After 6 weeks, how does the Dr. Scholl's Dynastep Sport Insert feel?
Before I tried the inserts, I had shin splint pain. Now I don't.
It's clinically proven among athletes to provide immediate relief from lower body pain.
When I play basketball, my lower back is much, much better.
Treat yourself right at drscholl's.com.
Wanted one person to watch televised sports all day.
Job includes playing video games and receiving massages.
Salary $100,000 to $150,000.
Leader, so dependable, there are more of them out there looking than any other small car.
Okay, come on, who's your dad?
Cavalier, we'll be there.
How U.S. gymnast Vanessa Adler eats a Reese's Peanut Butter Cup. There's no wrong way to eat a Reese's.
Magnetic Springs, the perfect place to test our new magnetic insoles.
My feet ache like the devil.
Our Dr. Scholl's Magna Energy insoles can help.
Each insole has a powerful magnet system inside.
Really cool.
We believe in magnets around here.
Are you one with the magnet?
Feels good.
Treat yourself right at drscholl's.com.
Welcome back, everyone, to Charlotte, North Carolina, and our All-State halftime report. No score between Iceland and the United States, and there's a good reason for that. It's the goalkeeper, Helga Dóttir of Iceland.
Oh, she's been so strong all game long. The U.S. has come at her with all kinds of attacks. Serves into the box for a header there by Brandi Chastain. She comes up big with it, and here's a Milbritt chance here. Comes up big on this 1-0 breakaway here by Milbritt. But look what happens to Mia Hamm late in the half. She gets her toe caught up in the grass, and she hit the boards very, very hard. She said, time to petition to move the boards back.
It was a good line. Iceland and the United States are scoreless at halftime. This has been the All-State Halftime Report. We're coming back to Charlotte, North Carolina for the start of the second half. Please come back with us.
At the Houston Camera Exchange, you can trade your old camera in for cash. Or trade it in for a new one.
Choose from three picture sizes with APS technology from Nikon. Save $40 and get the new low price on Nikon Pronia S kits. On sale, just $359. Plus, buy one now and we'll develop your film free for one full year.
We're the last real camera store. Why go anywhere else?
Houston Camera Exchange. 5900 Richmond, that's Mountain View.
Swing into spring with David Taylor Buick. Get $3,500 in total savings on the new David Taylor Buick Regal. Test drive and receive your free Golf USA $50 certificate plus a chance at winning a $1,000 custom set of golf clubs from Golf USA at West Oaks. Houston's best golf shop for personal service, professional club fitting, and value pricing. From David Taylor Buick.
Rock 101.
KLOL.
It was exciting but scary at the same time. It was just like for the whole world to see what emotion I was going to have if I went early, if I went extremely late, because you can't hide emotions from the camera.
Begins April 15th at noon on ESPN.
One in four of us believes in love at first sight. One in four tells it like it is. And one in four of us is born with genes that make us sweat more than others. Secret Platinum Protection. The strongest form of antiperspirant you can get without a prescription. pH-balanced Secret Platinum Protection.
When I bite into your cousin Miss Patty, my tongue tingles. My teeth chatter. My throat is cooled by the rapid chill of snow cascading around my body.
Wow. York Peppermint Patty. Get the sensation.
Bud Light, proud sponsor of the U.S. women's soccer team and the 2000 Olympic Games.
Hey, Brandy, watermelons are on sale.
Wait up, Frodo's.
After 6 weeks, how does the Dr. Scholl's Dynastep Sport Insert feel?
Before I tried the inserts, I had shin splint pain. Now I don't.
It's clinically proven among athletes to provide immediate relief from lower body pain.
When I play basketball, my lower back is much, much better.
Treat yourself right at drscholls.com. Welcome back to Charlotte, North Carolina. We're joined now by U.S. Women's National Team Head Coach April Heinrichs. Well, what'd you tell them in the locker room?
Well, the first thing is keep believing in what we're doing. You know, playing dynamic, playing great soccer. It's thoughtful. It's creative. And something will happen. And let's be decisive at the back to clean up any mistakes. And then we'll keep them away from our goal and we'll keep hunting a goal.
This wind is rough. You know, it takes a lot of wind to move my hair around. Anything you guys can do on the field to fight through it?
Actually, I think the wind is an advantage for us right now because now we're playing into it and the balls won't roll away from us so much. In the first half, a couple of balls rolled over the end line. I think playing into the wind will be an advantage.
Good, Coach. Thanks for your time.
Thanks, Rob. Thanks, April. Second half underway. A few seconds old. Iceland in blue, USA in white, 0-0. Iceland breaking down on that right side. Here comes a big shot that went wide of Mullenix. Shot taken by Ogmundsdottir. That's the first shot for Iceland. Took them all the way into the second half before they got one.
Here's a nice through ball. Look at Raquel Ogmundsdottir. She's got lots of time and space in there. That's what April Heinrichs says needs to be cleaned up. A little tighter on defense. Make sure they're in their shape early. But that was a nice chance. She didn't have any options in the box. She went ahead and took a shot.
This portion of the match is being brought to you by Motrin. Pushed all the way back. Chastain. Wagner. all the way across. No subs out there for either side. Iceland only brought 16 total players, so they only have five. Under these rules, you could sub up to as many as seven, but April Heinrich said she probably wouldn't go that high. Loose ball gathered in, far side. And Iceland will just clear it away. Halftime numbers show the domination from the United States in the first half of play. And look how many saves were made by Helgadottir. Some of them, at least three or four of them, brilliant.
And she, what she does, not only is obviously keeps the ball out of the net, but she's giving her defense a lot of confidence. And, you know, just knowing that they've got that stability behind them and, a player who's playing so well gives them so much confidence that they're okay. If the forwards get in behind them, they've got that last line of defense, and she is playing great.
Throw in coming up on the far side.
Who are you with? Who are you with? Okay.
Iceland holding onto the ball, far side, and they hold onto it no longer. Quick throw-in for the United States. And that one's going to be cleared away again, that bunker mentality. Iceland hanging tough right now, but they'll need Helgadottir to play as well as she did in the first half to have a chance here. Gudmundur Ryderson must have been positive in his locker room at halftime. Corner kick coming up for the United States. They only had a few in the first half. Mia Hamm gets ready to put it in play. 49th minute, first corner this half, and it's caught. Helgadottir maintaining her poise. She's been very busy with all kinds of different shots from the United States. They've varied the attack.
Well, they have, and I was really noticing the way the U.S. was setting up on those corner kicks offensively. All of their runs are actually starting from far out as opposed to posting a player up to provide a lot of pressure on Helgadottir. So she was able to come out without a lot of pressure on her and make that save.
Down the middle, Iceland coming back. That was well played by Jonsdottir with Mia Hamm putting some pressure on. Jonsdottir up the wing, she'll clear it. It's intended for Oegmundsdottir, didn't make it. Given away to Laurie Fair. The youngest U.S. player at the last World Cup. Allie Wagner down the middle. Well, she was not the intended target, and this one got away off the left foot. Goal kick coming up.
Here's McMillan again. She's been a great ball winner in the midfield, and this is a nice chip in. It looks like Milbert wants that, but Welsh goes ahead and takes it, tries to get a good shot off, and it just gets away from her.
Iceland coming back. Ingebergsdottir into the middle, give and go. And had that been handled better, there might have been a chance for a shot. Mullenix clears. Seven on the ball. Ingebergsdottir pushing it back. Ingebergsdottir facing the USA pressure, and they force a turnover there. USA will have it on a throw-in on the far side. Lilly with that throw-in for Wagner. Lilly plays it up. Milbert looking to turn. Tiffany Milbert to the outside, using that speed, and that time she lost the ball. Chastain is all the way back for it. Brandi Chastain turning it back upfield. She had the game-winning goal against Norway in the Algarve Cup final on a penalty kick. McMillan at the halfway line. She'll send it across. Lilly had to wait for it. Christine Lilly up the flank. Looking, finds Wagner. This pass finds Welsh in the turnaround. She'll play it back instead. Laurie Fair goes wider. Here's McMillan. They've got numbers now in the box. McMillan to the outside. Shakes loose from one. Plays it across. Intended for Lilly, and it's cleared.
Jiffy, at the beginning of the game, we talked about the need for the flank midfielders to go ahead and take on. That was one of the ways that April said that she wants them to get end line. And that was a nice job by McMillan. She takes her player on, and then she looks up and actually serves a beautiful ball into the box. There just wasn't anybody there at the top to finish it.
Shannon McMillan getting a lot more playing time under April Heinrich. We had a chance to catch up with McMillan and talk about that role in the change.
When you have a coach for so long, you know, you kind of tend to get used to how things are going. And when you have someone come in and shake things up, it's great because we're learning a lot under her. She herself is a proven champion as a player, and so she brings a lot of experience to this team and a lot of excitement and heart and soul that we definitely need.
Shannon McMillan talking about head coach April Heinrichs, former player and captain on this team that won the World Cup in 91 with her. Milgren, with three defenders going up against her, and it's cleared out. Iceland have gotten back in numbers in a hurry. But April Heinrichs knows if they keep this up, they're bound to score with all this pressure, all this possession. Another corner kick for the United States. Number five total. That's low for them. It's going to be Mia Hamm to take it. She'll send it across. It was deflected out. Another corner kick. Misplay by Helgadottir, but they'll do it again.
Now we finally see Joy Fawcett going in and fronting the keeper here. That's what the U.S. needed early on.
Hamm drives it across. Late run. And it doesn't go in. Welsh came flying through.
One critique I had of the corner was nobody was in the box. Now look, Fawcett makes this run in the box. She's just in there providing enough pressure on Helgadottir. Now the ball comes in, and look at Welsh. She's the player right here that should be finishing this, and it just goes right over her head. Chastain almost finishes on the back post. That should have been a goal by the United States.
All the way back it comes in their own end. It goes out for a USA throw, and this portion of the match is being brought to you by York Peppermint Patty. 54th minute, USA getting closer and closer, but still no scoring. Chastain on the throw-in. First across.
JP, we've seen so many games come down to set plays, things like corner kicks or throw-in plays, and that's where the United States is a little rusty. They're still in their preseason, as April says, and she's got a lot to work on to brush up on. But I do think they're missing some key personalities or players in the box on those corner kicks.
McMillan with a great juggling act from the sideline. This one will be Frieda Wagner, and a bad first touch cost her. It's still loose, though, in the box, and now a little holding by the USA inside. Wagner normally better on that first touch, not that time.
You got to one-touch that ball.
You were mentioning Julie Foudy not playing tonight. Rob Stone is standing by with Julie. Let's go downstairs.
Yeah, JP, we got her right here. So tell us, how come you aren't playing tonight? Is it too cold for you?
Exactly. Rob, I have a clause in my contract that says when it drops below 70 degrees, I don't have to play in games like this. I talked it over with April. She was okay about it. So I'm in the box eating pretzels. And
I got to get my agent to work on that. Truthfully, though, it's a groin problem,
I
right?
I have a slight groin issue, pull. And I did on Thursday and thought I could rest it for today. But with it being wet and cold and everything else, we just decided it wasn't smart.
We'll ask you to put on your little coaching cap. You've been upstairs in the box watching it from kind of a different viewpoint than you're used to. What are you noticing today?
We have a fabulous view up there. It's totally different, obviously, than when you're on the field. And they're playing like a 5-4-1, which is different than what they played against us on Wednesday when we beat them by a larger margin than 0-0. But so it's a defensive stance, obviously. They've dropped into a bunker, and that's something we're going to face a lot this year. And so this is a good challenge for us because we have to learn to play against that. We've always struggled against it, and I didn't make the halftime talk because we didn't go all the way down, but I'd like to hear what she said. But I could imagine they need to play quicker and switch the ball quicker and get around the outsides earlier.
Olympic preparation starting to heat up for you guys. We talked with April today. She said around July she'd kind of like to have things somewhat set. How are preparations coming in your mind as a co-captain?
Well, I think the hugest thing for us is we got rid of that Algarve curse, and we won that tournament just a couple weeks ago in Portugal, so that was a great start for us. I think this has been a great week in Charlotte. We started the first day with the Circle of Death fitness, so that kind of set the tone of what we have to look forward to, and then we have San Diego, of course, so a lot of good things and 5 months of great preparation.
All right, Julie, thanks for your time. You're welcome to hang out with me down here on the field if you want, but I got
to
feel...
Is
it warm up there? I'm following you. I know JP and Wendy are nice and cozy
there. We're toasty, yeah. Thanks, Rob. And Julie, coming back the other way. Iceland looking for a chance at the other end. Ingeborg's daughter making the run. USA have it covered, but now the pass gets through. And through again. Helgadottir deflected inside. Quick shot. Mullenix uses the footwork. Shot taken by Oldmansdottir. Plays to the club side. Breidablik by Wagner. Long ball. Can Milburn run onto it? Yes, she can. Two defenders back there. She'll play it inside, and she'll get it back off the deflection. And now it goes out. Throw-in coming up. Tomorrow night on ESPN at 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 Pacific, the Cleveland Indians take on the Tampa Bay Devil Rays on Sunday Night Baseball presented by Gumout. The Indians look to cruise to their sixth straight division title in the year 2000. USA looking for their first goal. Mia Hamm. The cross. And they can't make the connection to us.
JP, one thing I'm noticing is that a lot of the, especially in this half, the forwards are the ones who are getting in line and serving into the box, which means that the midfielders have got to make that run, work extra hard, and go ahead and try and fill the slots in the box.
On the advantage call, the turnaround shot from Welsh is stopped. Helga Dodder will put it back in play, well over the halfway line. Wagner will chase it. Sol Jonsdottir. Christine Lilly will watch it go out for a USA throw-in. McMillan holds up right side. Right through one defender. Couldn't get through a second. One by Iceland. Olafsdottir, number seven, plays it back. That ball was almost picked off. Dangerous ball backwards by the Iceland side. Knotted down. Olafsdottir. Couldn't find Jonsdottir. Joy Fawcett holds. Laurie Fair drives this ball across. Doesn't have enough height to it. Given away to Milbritt. Milbritt will chance. Saw the keeper out. Almost. That was a great idea by Milbritt. She saw the keeper out.
Well, it's interesting because what got Iceland in trouble was a bad clear. Here's a ball by Laurie Fair. Doesn't make it far side. Look at Milbritt's beautiful touch. Beats a player, and it just doesn't tuck under the post. It looked like she was going to get it. Here, another look at this. She jukes the defender, looks up, keeper's off her line, and she almost tucks it into that far corner.
Iceland coming back. Three on the attack for them, but about seven or eight coming back for the USA. Little starter played it across. Oldmanstorter will chase. Up goes. Sobrero will have a throw-in. If you've been listening to the game and you're wondering about all these names that end with Dodder, that is the father's name. And only one player on this team, Olga Fairset, who is not playing, goes by the family name. And as far as we know, only two of them are sisters, the goalkeeper and the captain. Coming back the other way, Iceland. Winning it back. Cleared by Hendriksdottir. USA scrambling to get it back. Alec Wagner does in the 60th minute. Long ball, but nobody is making that run down the middle. Iceland will clear.
JP, remember we had a chance to talk to April. She said that she's trying to get the team to play more direct, more penetrating passes. But I think they need to pick their times to do it. And Wagner, she served some nice balls in there, but that last time, she needed to go ahead and send it out wide. Mix it up a little bit because the Icelandic defense, there we go, she serves it out wide. That's beautiful. Now they're getting their width out of the midfield in Christine Lilly.
Lilly will carry it. Down she goes. And Rich Grady blows the foul on that. I think he was thinking about the advantage call, but saw when she went down, a stop play right there. Free kick for the United States. Over the ball, Hamm. That was a set play, but it didn't work. Laurie Fair's pass to Wagner. She turned. I don't think anybody told her there was somebody on her. It was Helgadottir who clears. Wagner. Halfway line. All the way across. Lilly now on the right side. Push back to Chastain. They continue with three at the back. So far tonight, stayed with it the entire match. Lilly will chase this down. Helgadottir. Cleared from the back by Jonsdottir. And now it's picked back up by Joy Fawcett. And apparently that entire ball was out intended for Welsh. And April Heinrich said before she could use up to seven subs if she wanted. Probably wouldn't because Iceland didn't have the depth, but you wonder at what point with it not breaking in the USA's favor when she might go to the bench.
Well, I would think because they are early on and this is what they consider their preseason, players aren't conditioned to play 90 minutes, so she could look at it as an opportunity to get some fresh legs off the bench and maybe make a difference that way.
McMillan leads it, left side. They tried a different player coming through that time, Sobrell. Another corner. Seventh corner kick for the United States. That's the first time we've seen Sobrero make that long run up the side. Now throw it instead. No corner. Here's Wagner. Milburn on the turn. Inside the box. On the left foot. She'll bend it across. It's cleared away. And Iceland will move it out with Jón's daughter. Joy Fawcett. Knotted down. Helga Daughters there. 63rd minute. Carla Overbeck sitting out watching this one. The USA team captain. You had a chance to talk to her at halftime. What was she talking about?
Well, she was saying that they needed to, this is a great opportunity for them to be playing against a bunker defense because they've always had trouble, you know, figuring it out. And you can tell Iceland has put 10 players behind the ball defensively. And it is tough for the United States, but they do need to, what they need to do is actually be a little more patient. You know, they're trying to be more direct, which is good, but they also need to be more patient. Try and get in line with the width coming out of the midfield.
Hams cross will go for a corner. This now will be the seventh corner kick. Fawcett's pushing forward for this. Chastain is up too. Mayhem drives it across. In the air, Chastain went wide. She met that ball in the air, did everything right except headed it wide.
Let's take a look here at this ball. We have Brandi Chastain and some other players on the back post here. Now watch them as they run in. Great ball across, comes away from the keeper. Okay, now freeze it there. Now what she needs to do is head it back in this direction, but instead she heads it this way. Watch that, that's the margin for error. If you head it back in the direction that it's coming from, the margin for error is going to keep it on the face of the goal.
13-2, the shots for the United States, their favorite. They've had the edge in the corners as well. Iceland, if you recall, didn't have a shot in the entire first half. In a space for Milbrandt. Almost went into her teammate, sends it up. And wide. Let's go downstairs now once more to Rob Stone.
Guys, a real subtle yet intelligent move made by head coach April Heinrichs. Christine Lilly moved from left midfield to right. Shannon McMillan coming over to the left side. The reason Iceland is really overplaying the U.S. on the outside flanks. So what she did is she moved those players so they can work their natural game inside. So Shannon McMillan is stronger on the right foot, so she's on the left side. If she cuts in, the ball is on her predominantly strong right foot. The same with Lilly. She makes a cut in. Now the ball is on her left foot. Something to watch for.
You know, I like that, especially with McMillan. Well, both of them have great shots. Very powerful shots. But McMillan, when she turns that corner and goes inside, we've seen her score a ton of goals. She scored a couple in the World Cup from that position, just basically at the top of the 18, gets a step on her player and rips it.
USA looking on that left sideline. Welsh to the end line. Save again by Helga Dotter. Corner kick. Eighth corner kick. These saves getting better and better. Lilly will take it. Drives it across. And it's cleared out. Ogren's daughter left it off. Iceland will clear. And out it goes for a USA throw-in.
Talk about youth. How about this explosion here? Look, she turns the corner. That's what Christy Welsh there, and comes in and actually puts a nice ball into Milbrandt. A little bit tough for her to handle. She had to try and take it down and gets a great shot off. But again, Helga Daughters on the other end of it.
That was her eighth save. This portion of the match is being brought to you by Secrets. And Helga Daughter may have been a secret before tonight. Not now. And more than half of those saves have been spectacular. She's been the difference. Foul is called. Just getting back up is Milbert. Wagner in the middle. Hand. Eight defenders almost inside the box around that area for Iceland as they clear out. All the way back, Sobrero. The USA is doing what they want in many respects, getting to the end line, making the passes, but the goalkeeper has been the story.
Well, she has been so strong, and like I keep mentioning, the confidence. It's not only confidence in her game, you can see that in her saves, but it's also giving her defense a lot of confidence.
Iceland's cleared out. In the air, Iceland wins. And they almost had possession. Helga Dóttir had it knocked away. USA will have a throw-in. 68th minute. Scoreless match. USA on the turn. Inside the box. Milbert leaves it off. Welsh can't get through. And it's turned away by Iceland. Ullmann's daughter. At the halfway line. And it's coming back. Welsh. One against two. And now one against five. And now it's going to be cleared out. We go downstairs again to Rob Stone.
April Heinrich's making the first sub of the game right now, and it's a defensive one. Kind of curious. Daniel Slate will be coming in. And they'll be adjusting now to a 4-4-2 lineup. And Danielle's just waiting to make the sub right now. I'm not sure what the holdup is. But coming out will be Christy Welsh. So again, they're changing formations
Welsh.
Now to a 4-4-2.
Thanks, Danielle, for that confirmation.
4-4-2.
So Slayton just told us all what Rob was talking about, the 4-4-2. They're going to change it right now. Slayton for Welsh. More room for the two front runners as well. And Slayton adds a lot of speed and fresh legs to this team.
Well, let's look and see if obviously the U.S. is not winning this game, so this has got to be a move that will help them offensively. So what that means, in my opinion, is that they're going to try and get Slayton and Fawcett in down the flank. So add an extra runner like Slayton's doing right now to get more players wide. We'll see if that is, in fact, what happens.
Iceland looking for it. Ullmann's daughter broke it up for the moment by Wagner. Then Milbert flashed in, but couldn't win the ball. Jon's daughter clears. We're in the 70th minute. No score. It's reminding me of the game in Bethlehem as you look at Daniel Slayton, only 19 years old from San Jose, California, part of the new wave of players. Get used to some of these names. They might be on the Olympic team come September in Sydney. On the right side, Lily. Pushing it back to Sobrero. There are some of the fresh faces. Look at the ages of these players. So many teenagers on this team. The average age of this team on Wednesday is 20.3 years. Here's the long ball. Into the box. Late clearance, but they get away with it. Hendricks Dóttir cleared. Chastain is back for it. All the way back. And Wagner will play it back to the feet of Mullenix. Back in 98, it was only a 1-0 win for the USA over Iceland after they trounced them a few days before. Natalie Neaton scored around the 78th minute or so, very late in that game. That one, though, was played in the driving rain.
Which we almost had today.
Yeah. We were fortunate.
It's not unusual for, in a second game of a matchup, for a team, you know, like an Iceland, obviously, to adjust into a system that's going to be very, very difficult for the United States, and that being the bunker. And this is what the United States is trying to figure out right now.
Slayton for Ham, and touched out by Mia. So there's a goal kick for Helga Dóttir.
One of the ways you beat a bunker defense is a long ball serve into a point person up top, and that's where I really feel like they're missing Cindy Parlow tonight. She's a great target player. They don't have that height up top. You know, in order to have a good long ball serve, a flick, and then players like Milbert and Ham running off of that type of offensive attack.
Lily with a little juggling. She's broken up. Pushed to the right side. Lori Fair. Milbert couldn't turn inside. Ullmann's daughter on the quick turn. Played it to the middle. Helga Dóttir. Engberg's daughter, and Mullenix backpedals to make that grab. Not a busy day for Mullenix so far. The busy goalkeeper is at the other end. Helga daughter playing, I'm sure, the international match of her life. Contact was made there, and Novak's upset because it seemed like she had the advantage. So they'll bring it back. Quick restart. Left side. Almost caught Iceland napping, but the USA didn't execute. Slayton on the wing. Left sideline. Cutting. Bending it inside. That one almost made it. Helga Dóttir got her hands on it, and it looked like it was going to go in from this angle. Another corner kick. Lori Fair was going to take it. Maybe not now. Now Lily's going to come over. This portion of the match being brought to you by Tropicana. They'll go with a short corner. Mia Hamm has it blocked out for a throw-in. In the 73rd minute. Lily. Blocked. Fights for the ball. Christine Lily was right there. And she'll get possession back against Ugman's daughter. Off the throw-in. Hamm tried to get around her defender. That one's cleared out of play. Again, a USA corner kick from Mia Hamm. The ninth one. And she'll leave it now for McMillan instead.
Remember that McMillan likes to serve a driven ball across the box. She's got Fawcett near post. She just doesn't get a hold of that one. The point I was going to make is that those driven balls into the box, that's what the player loves to run onto. And we saw them score a couple goals like that in the World Cup. Very successful. It's real tough for the defense to clear, but boy, if you make the right run, you can really get a good head on it.
Randy Chastain. Try to pass it through. Knocked out. Still belongs to the United States on the far side. Lily wants to take advantage with a quick throw in for Wagner. She can't get through. It's cut off. And now cleared by Iceland. Ugman's daughter is the lone striker, as she has been for much of the day. Fawcett, right side. Wagner, broken up. Helga Dóttir. Three on the attack now for Iceland. They're not looking for a goal necessarily. They'll take 0-0, but if they could sneak one in or have a numerical advantage, they'll go for it on the counterattack. McMillan had it thumped right off Jon's daughter. Fawcett drives it long. Mia Hamm back to Milbritt. That one's broken up as well. Iceland near the halfway line. Fawcett retreats. Back to Sobrero. Now Lori Fair. So much possession tonight for the United States. The advantage in the shots, the corners, you name it. But no goals.
JP, a critique of the midfield, the central midfield. Fair and Wagner are playing in there. Typically, we see Akers and Foudy, in the veteran regime, but they're out to injury. I think that Fair and Wagner are both getting caught very flat. They're both either going up on the attack. There isn't one of those two players who's playing that pivot point like we always see Akers. She gets the ball, she changes the point of the attack. She gets the ball, changes the point of the attack. And I think that's one thing that has hurt the United States on their offensive development.
On that far side, it's going to be cleared away. No goals to talk about tonight in terms of the game summary here in the 76th minute. But the story is Helga Dóttir, 8 saves, several of them brilliant. Mullenix has only had to make a couple as the USA has outshot Iceland by a wide margin. McMillan driving it. That's blocked. Lily and Wagner can't combine. Ugman's daughter. Trying to turn on Sobrero, who stays right with her. Gudlaug Jonsdottir. Long clearance the other way. Settled there in goal by Suri Mullenix. Another one of those great Carolina goalkeepers. They've had a tradition there, winning, and those goalkeepers. There's McMillan. Picked off at the other end. Here comes Iceland at the halfway line. Still going. Olafsdóttir couldn't continue her run, at least not with the ball. fouled in the process coming back. Lilly with a quick restart, taking advantage of that experience, but no one is joining on the attack. Now they come through, and it's Lilly again. Lilly's shot was blocked, and now it's cleared. Sobrero out wide, and the offside flag just went up. They scored us in the 77th minute. Iceland will put it back in play. Gunnar Stotter. Brought down the other way. Taken back by the United States. Chastain. Wagner. Fair. More possession for the U.S. McMillan. Into the corner area. The run is by Fawcett. Trying to lift it up. Right to the middle. Header. Milver was there, but it seemed like she headed it right at Helgadottir.
Look at this great run by Fawcett. We called that early on with the substitution change. Great header by Milver, but you know what she needs to do? Head it back in the direction it comes from. Instead, she headed it right at the keeper. That would have been a goal.
More live action as McMillan tries to run. Iceland with the ball. You know, by this time, I bet Iceland's acting head coach probably figured he'd be making some substitutions, but why change things? This is a great experience for his team. Still scoreless. Played back to Milbritt. Milbritt's getting a lot of the chances tonight, but her finishing has left something to be desired on several of these plays. Early on, she had better chances. Her best chance was one where she tried to chip the keeper and put it over.
I agree with you, JP, and I think probably the difference right now for her is that she's, you know, all these players are coming off of a break, and the finishing is not the thing that comes to you right away after you've had a break. So she needs to spend some time in practice. It's just surfaces that you're using, you know. It's a matter of using the inside of your foot versus the outside of your foot, things like that, or heading it, you know, tactically versus technically.
Look who's behind the defense. Mia Hamm. And when she misses like that, you got to wonder what kind of a night it is. Was on Mia like.
Look at this combination here. 1-2 ball here. And Hamm gets in behind the defense. She's trying to shoot it probably low, far post, but I think Helgadottir gets a hand on it. Again, we'll take a look here. This is a great ball here. She beats the defense, looks up, doesn't have anybody in the box as an option. I think Helgadottir flicks it, although they're calling for a goal kick.
On the replay, I thought she did too. Not live, but on the replay, I thought. 18-3 of the shots. How about Milver with 8 shots? That's an incredible amount of shots for a player. Sometimes teams don't get that against the United States. Join us at ESPN2 next week for the 2000 Bachelon Championships. Defending champ Monica Seles will be on hand against some of women's tennis' biggest names. Coverage begins on ESPN Friday, April 14th at 2 p.m. Eastern, 11 a.m. Pacific on ESPN. All the way back, this is Slayton, the leader on this team in minutes played. And a pleasant surprise, according to April Heinrichs.
Another player coming out of the great program at Santa Clara, and if anybody, people who got to watch the national championship collegially, she had a great weekend that weekend, and she is a legitimate player, and obviously getting a lot of time, which is going to help develop her game very quickly.
All the way up that far flank, USA attacking, and check back, Wagner, long ball, but it's right down the middle instead of on the flank. Tiffany Milbert giving it up in the left. Hamm trying to find Milbert or Lilly. Mia will chase it on the wing. She keeps it in play. Lilly looking to turn and lay it off. She does. Wagner's shot was blocked. Slayton bends it inside. It stays up. Milbert can't find it. McMillan with a drive that's blocked. All of a sudden, Iceland are getting their bodies in and blocking a lot of these shots. Flicked inside, and now it's cleared out. So the defenders who have made a few mistakes today are all of a sudden rallying around the goalkeeper. The confidence maybe you were talking about before.
Well, to be 0-0 in the 82nd minute against the United States is an unbelievable triumph for a team like Iceland. This is a great experience for them. They've done a really good job.
Sobrero, there's nobody on that post. And then Hamm runs into Helgadottir. 82nd minute. Iceland is so close.
There you go. Calling for Danielle Fotopoulos.
Goal kick for Helga Noder. She'll play it long. Look out here. Mullenix came out. Seemed like she may have hesitated a bit. This is cleared. Helga Noder with a shot. The USA could end up 0-0 here and chalk it up to running against the hot goalkeeper, but if they lose 1-0, that's a different story. That might be more tough to swallow.
We wouldn't be happy with that result, that's for sure.
Here's your star. April Heinrichs knows. I mean, she's seen good goalkeeping, and that's what you're going up against tonight. Simple.
And it comes down to the finer things. It comes down to choices on your shot when you're trying to finish. You know, like we mentioned earlier, what surface of the foot that you use or where you head the ball. But that's what it comes down to, corner kick set pieces.
Leon's got her. That one's blocked. Mullenix will call for it and come up with it.
You know, another player I miss not seeing out there is Tisha Venturini. At a moment like this in the game, she's always coming out of the midfield, usually coming off the bench and coming out of the midfield, and she'll get two or three, you know, scoring chances in the last few minutes of the game.
One of the five from the last World Cup, not part of the 30-player residency camp that'll be in San Diego. On the run, Slayton. Tripped them from behind, free kick coming up. We don't want to give up free kicks here, not this late, not to this team. Defending World Cup champions. Milbert puts it down, drives it. Oh, it's headed out. That's a bad corner to give up for Helga Dotter. Number 10 in terms of corner kicks. Mia Hamm goes over to take it. There's no real pressure there. She should have been able to play that one better. 84th minute. Hamm gets ready. Lily makes a run. So does Chastain. It never makes it across. Wagner can't get to it. It comes back. Kate Sobrero. Right side, McMillan. Lily has it tackled away. Shannon McMillan back on the right side. Off it goes, off of Laurie Fair, who recovers it. Back for Slayton. USA down now to the 85th minute. Still 0-0. Hamm pushing it through. That's Slayton. In deep. Bends it across. Well, she's made some dangerous passes from that left flank. She's added a lot to the team since coming in. Right now it's time to bring you our All-State save of the game. Here it comes.
And, of course, the player on the other end of this Milbert opportunity is Helga Dotter. She's come up big all game long, playing with unbelievable confidence. I would venture a guess that this is the game of her career.
Good guess. That's our All-State save of the game, and we could have picked any one of four others, I think. That's how well she has played tonight. The difference has been in goal in this game. Nearly 85 minutes gone in this one. This would be so huge for Iceland if they could even come away at 0-0. And now, on the break, Ogmund's daughter took it away from Fair. Laurie Fair, nice recovery. And then the bad pass back. Helga Dotter fires it, but it's right at Mullenix in the 86th minute. Can you imagine what that coach is like right now inside of his stomach, Ryderson? What a feather in his cap if Iceland could come away without losing this match. They're getting ready for Euro 2001 qualifiers. They've already played some, but he said playing against the United States will help them when they play again against Italy and Germany. Brought down, Hendricks daughter. Sobrero will chase it back. Mullenix is there. Siri Mullenix clears off the right foot, and it goes out. Not what she wanted to do. Hendricks daughter with a throw-in. McMillan, intercepted. Hendricks' daughter again, looking for Ugman's daughter. And instead, Siri Mullenix is there. Danielle Slayton, left side. Lily's back now on that far side.
You got it. Thanks, man.
She'll push it back. Slayton gave it up. Left sideline. Lily. Looking to use the sideline. That's good defense one-on-one against Christine Lily. Sometimes she plays like she owns that sideline. All the way back, Sobrero looks over the shoulder. Recovered well, that ball handcuffed her for a moment. Here's Wagner. Granny Chastain. Looking for McMillan. You know, to April Heinrich's credit, she's giving 90 minutes to a lot of players that she'd like to see more of. It's going to be great for Allie Wagner to get 90.
Oh, that's it's huge for her. I mean, getting that much international experience, 90 minutes, is absolutely huge. That's great for her development.
And she's starting tonight, Allie Wagner, because Julie Foudy had the groin injury. Was originally given to us in the starting lineup.
Right. Just about an hour before the game, they decided that it wasn't worth taking the chance, because earlier today, I mean, the field looks great right now, but it was torrential downpour, and anything a little bit wet, a little bit slick could you know, be all that Foudy needs to pull it.
McMillan with one nice move. Going to the end line, trying to get another corner. She won't there, but she'll get a throw in deep for her side. Chastain comes over to take it. Looking. Mia Hamm by the end line. This time, the U.S. will get another corner. 11. Shannon McMillan gets ready. Time is running out. In the 89th minute, she'll hook it, and it hits off the crossbar and goes out of play. April Heinrichs and her coaching staff looking on at what has to be an upset. This is a team that were beaten by the United States, 8-0 on Wednesday, and maybe it would have been the same story tonight without this kind of goalkeeper.
She has been great. Definitely the player of the match for Iceland.
I mean, this is as great goalkeeping I've seen against the U.S. team. As the ball was cleared out again, another throw-in for Iceland. And if they're smart, they'll take their time on every situation like this. And this is huge for them. All the way back, USA with Sobrero. Out it goes. USA's ball in a quick throw-in. In his space. And they'll just play safe. Garner's daughter cleared it out. You can tell how pleased Iceland's coach is, because he didn't make any substitutions at all. This is great experience for these players to play a full 90 against the defending World Cup champs and to know that they might come away with a scoreless match. Far side, Milbert. Knocked out another corner. 12th one, short one, right to the middle. And hot three. Fawcett was not the intended target there, but she almost became it. Allie Wagner near her side. In the 90th minute, Iceland coming away with the ball. Henrik Stoltz looks for it. Now it comes wide. A couple of minutes of stoppage time. Added on as Slayton goes after it. It's tackled out. Goal kick off Slayton. And there's the official confirmation of the stoppage time. And Helga Gother will put it back down. She is so close.
Chippy, I'd love to have a mileage tracker on Slayton. She has gotten up and down that left flank probably about 10 times since she subbed into the match, and she's really trying to make a difference. Very, very impressed with her.
USA brings it down. Switch wide, left side. McMillan. Little holding, and let it go. She had an advantage anyway. Fawcett. Try to lift it. That one's blocked by Jon's daughter. Headed up. Helga daughter. Again, good second and third effort. Jon's daughter clears. Fawcett. Right side for Hamm. Oh, they've broken the bunker several times tonight, but they've not been able to score past Helga daughter, who's been brilliant, absolutely brilliant in goal tonight. Here's Wagner. 1 minute gone in stoppage time. They'll play two. It's settled. It's Lily. Puts it on the left foot. tackled away and rolls out for a corner. The 13th corner kick for the United States. Christine Lilly striking it, an in-swinger, headed out. A missed kick there from Iceland. Fair brings it back. Chastain is blocked. And Iceland playing it safe again. It's a good idea. Set for the throw-in. Chastain. Edge of the box, Wagner. Cleared out. Laurie Fair to Fawcett. With time running out, they'll go wide again. Maybe one more chance. Lilly. Knocked down. The foul was called. It's outside the box. This might be it. Iceland better get organized. You might be looking at the last kick of the ball. We're over the 2 minutes of stoppage, which Grady will allow this to be played through, and that's probably it. From the far side, chipped in. Flick, save! Helga Dodder, I think, puts the exclamation point on this game for Iceland.
I mean, what a perfect ball into the box. And look at Chastain back post. One time flick, but what a great way for Helga Dodder to end that game.
That was the
save.
Final save. That was it. Game over. 11 saves for Helga Dodder. One was as good as the next. This guy inside Ryderson, his stomach has to be churning. He comes in here, acting coach. They get a 0-0 draw against the defending World Cup champs. They were so strong in goal.
Well, they were, and you can tell that she gets a lot of confidence from him because he's a former goalkeeper. But boy, I'll tell you, Helga Dodder's confidence in goal, you could see it in the whole entire team as the time went on. They got close to the 80th minute. It didn't matter. They were going to hang in there.
It ends up as a scoreless match between Iceland and the United States, and the USA knew that they had the artillery moving. They shot everything they could at this goalkeeper, Helga Dodder, who comes away with a shutout against the defending World Cup champs. It's going to be a nice flight home.
Experience life in a room with a view, sheltered from the elements and cradled in the arms of nature. Rooms with a View combines the beauty of nature with the total comforts of indoor living. So whether it's a solarium or a garden room, Rooms with a View provides financing and complete installation to ensure your family total perfection in living. So call today for a free estimate at 1-800-522-2171 and save 40% on a garden room designed exclusively for year-round enjoyment.
At the Houston Camera Exchange, you can trade your old camera in for cash.
Or trade it in for a new one.
See the full line of Canon Elks and check out the brand new Canon Elks 4. It takes advanced photo system technology underwater. Plus, the original Elk has a new low price. Take an extra $40 off.
We're the last real camera store. Why go anywhere else?
Houston Camera Exchange, 5900 Richmond, that's Mountain View.
So you're locked out of your car.
Yeah.
Is that the Stanley Cup?
Yeah.
Oh, man.
The Stanley Cup playoffs begin Wednesday at 7 on ESPN and ESPN2.
Wanted one person to watch televised sports all day.
Job includes playing video games and receiving massages.
Salary $100,000 to $150,000.
So dependable, there are more of them out there working than any other small car.
Okay, come on, who's your dad?
Cavalier, we'll be there.
Welcome back, everyone. Wendy, all those shots, no goals for the United States.
Sometimes that's what the tight matches come down to, is how you execute set pieces or how you finish on net, and the United States just didn't do that well tonight.
They had so many chances, including the chances by Tiffany Milbert. She's Chevrolet's Woman of the Match. Chevrolet will donate $1,000 to the U.S. Soccer Foundation in Tiffany Milbert's name. Now let's go downstairs to Rob Stone.
Thank you, JP. We're joined now by Brandi Chastain and our Chevrolet Woman of the Match, Tiffany Milbert. Ever remember a game? So many shots on net, yet nothing found home.
Oh, yeah. Sometimes just as the goals go in, sometimes that's the way it goes. The keeper, she was, got to give her credit. She was everywhere she needed to be today.
Brandi, we're talking about this earlier. This kind of had a feeling like maybe this wasn't meant to be with all those opportunities, especially that last second one you had at the end.
Well, absolutely. I mean, I think, you know, just good isn't good enough sometimes, and you got to make a spectacular play or a great save like the goalkeeper did, and that's the difference. And, you know, I thought we played very hard. We worked on a lot of things this week, getting around the outside. I thought we did that. We got in line, a lot of services. We just didn't find the net. said. And in a game like this, it's something to grow on.
One to grow on, like they say, right? Guys, thanks for your time. Go inside and get warm. JP, Wendy, back to you.
Get warm. Great thoughts, Rob. Thanks for all of the action tonight and for staying with us. Up next, the 1999 World Strongest Man Competition. For Wendy Gabar and Rob Stone, I'm John Paul Della Camera. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For more, log on to ESPN.com.
10 lists. I'm Andrea Joy.
And I'm Rob Weller.
From technology and expedition to the everyday how-to. Make Discovery's critically acclaimed and award-winning programming your very own. Quality and excellence for only $19.95 plus shipping and handling. Call now to order. There's no thrill like Discovery.
Women's soccer has come of age. The world's best players have a league of their own.
This is something that we've dreamt about. It's been a long time coming.
It's just growing constantly, and it's everywhere.
On the field, the competition will be fierce, but there will be winners everywhere.
It will change how people view women athletes, women in leadership roles, forever.
Women athletes, the best in the country and in the world, have come to the Olympic Training Center in Chula Vista, California, hoping to stake a claim to history.
Carol Chen, you gotta go. You just went in.
They're competing for positions in the first women's professional soccer league in this country, the WUSA. The birth of the league is a story of vision, perseverance, stamina, and sweat. And it represents just how far women have come in professional sports. For the athletes and those they inspire, it's a dream come true. The league kicks off in the U.S. in April 2001. It has 8 star-studded teams, a 21-game season, and a $64 million commitment from its cable operator investors to back it up. Tony DiCicco, a pro women's soccer league, cannot come soon enough. DiCicco is the chief operations officer of the new league and former head coach of the 1999 World Cup champions.
With the World Cup for the USA, he's done it.
Helping give birth to a women's pro soccer league has been a burden of joy for DiCicco throughout 2000 and 2001.
What I wanted to accomplish as head coach was to win a World Cup, to win an Olympic Games, and to see a women's professional league emerge.
But talking about launching a women's professional league is one thing. Actually making it happen is another.
Putting together the ingredients for a successful professional sport today is very different than it was 25 or 30 years ago when the NFL started, or the NBA really came into its own. Right now, television is absolutely key, and the amount of money it takes to brand a new league, to really make it a household name, it's just humongous.
With the help of Soccer Dad and Discovery Channel founder John Hendricks, the WUSA was not that far off from becoming a reality. But it took Hendricks' passion for the players and his hard-nosed business acumen to get past the initial cynicism. He managed to enlist an impressive group of investors, but financial backing wasn't the only element needed to create the league. Good management and, most importantly, star power were just as important.
When you were growing up, did you have any, like, idols who, like, inspired you?
Julie Foudy.
Tony DiCicco remembers what happened after he was asked to join the league as a consultant.
John needed every player from the World Championship team to be part of the league because the investors wanted that. And at the meeting he held, every player committed to John's vision and their dream to be part of the league.
With Mia Hamm, Brandi Chastain, and the rest of Team USA on board, the 20 founding players that achieved star status by winning a gold in the 1996 Olympics and the World Cup in 1999 were committed to play in the first ever Women's United Soccer Association. The search for the rest of the players was next on the agenda. But how do you find players at the level of Julie Foudy and Mia Hamm? The league's approach? Secure every player domestically and internationally.
I've been on the road. So I was in Norway, Germany, Sweden, Denmark, actually in China this fall, trying to secure the top international players, because our claim is to be the best league in the world, the best professional women's league in the world.
To live up to that claim, the league had to get the top international players to compete.
So please, a warm welcome for Katia of Brazil.
It was a challenge at times. I mean, it's cultural differences.
Ceci from Brazil. And finally, from Norway, Anne Christine Aranis.
Luring foreign players took a lot of convincing.
We had to kind of say, you know, look, together, this is going to have a great impact, and it's going to raise the standard of women's soccer, not just in our country, but around the world.
One of the women the league went after was China's Sun Win. Sun Win stole the hearts of the WUSA officials.
When she stood up at our global draft, she was the first pick.
Sun Win from the Republic of China.
She came up to accept that and spoke English. People were just so moved by that.
I'm so excited to have this opportunity to play for WUSA.
The WUSA will have 8 teams in San Diego, the Bay Area, Atlanta, Boston, New York, North Carolina, Washington, D.C., and Philadelphia. With 3 founding players allocated and 2 foreign players drafted to each of the teams, there were 15 players yet to recruit. So 2 tryouts were set to select the remaining players.
We made sure we sent out letters to all of our amateur programs, the W League, WPSL, to their coaches, their teams, to the college programs. We went to many of the amateur events.
Go down on your side, just collapse it down.
So we really scoured the pavement, so to speak, to make sure we'd given every player the chance.
Good run, Birdie. Good run, Birdie.
The clock is on.
28 players were drafted to each team. It did not necessarily guarantee them a permanent spot in the WUSA, because all of the drafted players from each of the teams will have to compete for a coveted spot during the 10-day preseason tournament in Chula Vista, California.
The rhythm of the play.
At Chula Vista, the coaches are scheduled to make their final cuts.
Now, it is my great pleasure.
But draft choices, star players, and great business heads cannot always promise success. The WUSA knows they've got to fill the stadiums, something other pro leagues in America have failed to do.
We have to change the habits of soccer people. We've got unbelievable numbers out there that play soccer, that follow soccer, the soccer mom syndrome, the soccer family thing. But we've got to now kind of lure them into being soccer fans, because they're not. And it's a thing where if you drive your child to 2 practices on Tuesday and Thursday, and then you play a game on Saturday, are you going to want to go Saturday night or Sunday to see to another soccer event?
One of the challenges that we're going to have is
New York Power general manager Susan Marinoff knows how important the grassroots effort is to make that connection and get those stadium seats filled. She realized just how important when she brought her team out to sell the league.
There's 2 components to today, autograph signing and also sportsmanship awards.
Because we're based here in Long Island, our first and foremost is to reach that soccer niche on Long Island. And just today, for instance, we were in Huntington for the Long Island Junior Soccer League convention. And we have our players out there signing autographs. We have our players talking to who is our market, the youth market, the girls and the boys.
New York Power player and World Cup champion Tiffany Milbrett knows that making a player-to-fan connection is one of the best ways to get soccer fans out to the stadium.
Well, I think it's really important because I think everybody knows Team USA, you know, because it's their team and we've been really successful, but nobody really realizes that now we're branching off and forming the WUSA, which is the Women's Professional League, and I think that's what people need to learn about, and that's why it's important for us to come out to the community, because we're their team. This is their, you know, we're their community's team.
Another important challenge the league faces is finding the right venues.
Part of the challenges in soccer in America is that we don't have the right venues to play in. The men's professional leagues have tried to go to the largest stadiums, the NFL stadiums, if you will, and it's hard to make it look successful, even when you have 20 or 25,000 in those stadiums, because they're 70,000-seat stadiums. and our view has been to try to take it to small, festive, fan-friendly, but special stadiums. Stadiums between 7,000 and 15,000.
Some of the WUSA stadiums are in tip-top condition. Others have not been professionally maintained. WUSA CEO Barbara Allen was shocked when she saw Boston's Nickerson Field.
We drove to a giant hole in the ground. Deposited in the middle of this hole in the ground were very large chunks of concrete. I am not sure how all that comes together to form a soccer field, but he assured me it does.
Executives, players, and coaches work round the clock to pull it all together. They all yearn for one thing before launch. More time.
We'd all like to have more time, and you know, if next year was the better time, it would be great because we could get more prepared. But we won the World Cup in 1999. The team played in the Olympics in 2000. This has to be the launch year.
Getting down to the nitty gritty, and 7 weeks seems like a long time, but it's right around the corner.
And so is home, as Tony heads back after a very long day.
It's not like work to me, you know. I mean, some days you're running ragged, but it really isn't like work. You're caught up in what you want to see achieved and your own vision, but the shared vision.
We've got a great group of athletes. We've got great, great investors. We've got a lot of work to do to accomplish our goals, but I like our chances.
This program is brought to you in part by Ace Hardware, the place with the helpful hardware folks.
You've closed in your new home. Everything's perfect.
What?
Okay, not everything.
I got it. Don't worry about it, honey.
You could always add more storage space. Or fix that jammed door jam.
Honey, you okay? Fine.
After all, new homes have their share of
who's your hero now,
unexpected
honey?
Surprises. Life's an ongoing project. Ace.
On now, women's soccer comes of age, uninspired to win, on the Discovery Channel. Presenting the 30-day money-back Discovery adventure. Buy a 2001 Land Rover Discovery Series 2. Drive it for 30 days or 1,500 miles. And if you're not completely satisfied, bring it back for a full refund. Come see what a Discovery is made of.
Everybody's tired of winter, so Toys R Us announces spring. Splash into fun with great savings on outdoor pools, plus swing sets, scooters, bikes, everything for outdoor fun. Hey, if you want to get out, you got to come in.
You're watching the Discovery Channel.
Coach to give more coach passengers more room where they need it most. Enjoy more room only on American.
You're watching the Discovery Channel. Every Tuesday night, you're on the case. Three real-life dramas, one night of discovery. The prosecutors, the new detectives, the FBI files. Every Tuesday night, you're on the case. Beginning at 8 on the Discovery Channel.
If you're tired of those same old screaming car guys, tired of the over-aggressive salespeople and high-pressure tactics, then you'll love Southwest Lincoln Mercury. That's because for over 35 years, Southwest Lincoln Mercury has been providing Houstonians with an alternative. Friendly faces, a comfortable but affordable car buying experience. And at Southwest Lincoln Mercury, we still carry the largest selection of Lincolns and Mercurys at the lowest prices. Southwest Lincoln Mercury, where customers send their friends.
The way to go. The cyber cats are moving to a cyber beat. Cyber living, cyber playing, cool and sweet. Leaving cyber IRS to save a little cyber stress.
Get your refund in half the time. Ask your tax preparer to use IRS e-file or use your own computer. Even sign electronically.
40 million people already know e-file.
The Women's Soccer League offers players something they've never had before, a professional league of their own. Now, young women like these have a special goal to strive for, a future in soccer after they've graduated from college. Meet Jennifer and Margaret Tietzel. They're twins, they're 23, and they're double trouble on the soccer field. Since the age of six, they've shared a passion for soccer, playing together through high school in their hometown of Huntington, Long Island. They both went on to win soccer scholarships at the University of Connecticut, where they majored in physical therapy. When the twins heard about the draft for the new Women's Soccer League, there was never a question about trying out. It was a dream come true.
When we were in high school, I remember there was a paper going around saying, you know, would you want to start up a women's professional league? And you always thought, like, oh, that would be great, you know, but it was never a theory. You never would think that would happen. You know, you played your whole life, you devoted your whole life to soccer, and to see this, you know, actually getting paid to play in this professional league starting, it's like, how can you let that pass by? You got to jump right into the bandwagon. Am I going to hit you? No.
They've had one advantage most other players don't. Always someone to play with. And they have parents who support them.
The girls have always played a halfback position. It's constant running up and down that field. And they don't seem to get tired.
The Tietzen twins thrive on competition.
Yeah!
A quality their father instilled in them.
We used to compete when they were 4 years old, 5 years old in here, not with soccer, but I would time and them running around the kitchen and whoever got back about 9 points or 8 points. So they love to compete.
Sometimes the top one is very pinky. I even blush.
While they love competition, they no longer compete against each other on or off the field.
Yeah, there's a lot we share, so we have to go and buy our own things. You always look over your shoulder to see how, you know, see how Margaret's doing and stuff, and that's why people ask us if we're competitive. And our answer is always, well, we're not competitive to beat each other. It's always competitive to, you know, be equal with one another.
In December, the twins joined 200 hopefuls in Boca Raton, Florida, as they competed to be part of the very first professional women's soccer league in the country.
We met up with all our college friends and people we played against in the past, against different colleges, and it's a great atmosphere to play in, so it's nerve-wracking, but it's exciting at the same time. It's just this anxious feeling, this waiting to know what's going to happen with my future is the nervous part about it all, but just the feeling of being down here, if you're one of the 200 girls down here, not many girls have this opportunity.
After a week of tryout games, where all the girls got to show their stuff, they gathered on December 11th to hear the final draft results. Not everyone could be chosen for the 8 teams in the league, and Jennifer and Margaret listened nervously as the names of the draft picks were called out.
Okay, going to San Diego Spirit from University of Notre Dame, defender or midfielder, Kara Brown.
Margaret finally hears her name. She's drafted by the San Diego Spirit team.
My initial feeling when we first got drafted was a big sigh of relief because it was definitely a nerve-wracking experience. It was like, okay, phew, I made it now. I was just waiting to see, you know, my sister, what team she was going to.
Soon, the tense waiting is over.
Happy to announce we have another set of twins playing for the WUSA. Jennifer Tietzen who will be playing for the Philadelphia Stars from the University of Connecticut. Congratulations, sir.
This is one of our most nerve-wracking times, you know. Your name gets called, and you're excited that you get drafted and everything, and then after a while it starts saying, okay, she's going to the West Coast, I'm going to go.
With the great news that they both had been drafted, they immediately called their father and mother.
Her first reaction was a little, she's like, oh, shoot. I'm like, what? She's like, I'm just not ready for it. I think what they put it simply, it's bittersweet, you know, they're excited and thrilled, and then the other part is we're splitting up and moving far away from each other and from the families.
Those are mine.
So I'm here just to watch and see what she's taking, because we still share our clothes.
JT, she has initialed her jeans, so I don't take them.
She hides stuff. I found stuff she's stashing away on the side of her bed, so I don't take it when we pack.
Their mother, Anne, actually finds it harder to watch them leave this time than when they went off to college.
We're delighted that they're able to fulfill their dreams, but it's a bittersweet kind of thing.
Are you having a little college? Are you sure?
Yeah, it fits perfect.
When they went off to college, I didn't quite feel they were adults yet, so I felt I had some control. But as they've been home for the last year, I realize our control is dwindling rapidly. So I think this is a little harder. Seems to be more final.
The girls have begun to reflect on the changes their new careers with the league might bring to their personal lives.
Well, he's going. You're leaving March 3rd.
Jennifer is engaged to Darren Prozo, and they plan to be married in early September. Margaret's boyfriend, Mike Amarillo, is a physical therapist in Connecticut.
Make it easy on you.
I just want to say I wish you guys good luck. You worked really hard. I know you're really excited, and I hope you do very well.
It's hitting me now because it's something, you know, when I was a little kid, when I played ball, I'm like, yeah, I want to be a professional athlete. Now it's like the roles are reversed. You know, I'm going to be in the so-called wife section, but husband section.
He's going to be knitting in a
beer. Eating a beer and a hot dog. Hey, go, Jay. Good job. It's just what's going to happen, you know. She's going to be staying in shape. I'm going to get a belly. Hey, no problem. You know? That's great. I'm excited.
Jennifer's team is based in Philadelphia, only about a three-hour trip from home. Margaret faces a greater separation from Mike. She's headed to San Diego, 3,000 miles away.
I'd like to go out there, but I don't know if I'm ready for that right now because I'm pretty stable here. And I think both of us have, like, tried to ignore the fact that she's leaving soon, right? We don't talk about it much.
No, not at all.
So I'm going to miss her a lot, I guess. And when she leaves and I leave her off at the plane, I think it's really going to hit me.
There's one other big challenge the girls face when they get to training camp. Like all the rookies, they don't know for sure yet if they will make the final cut. One or both of the twins could be dropped from their teams. Each team general manager drafted 28 girls. Now they must cut back to 20 players for the official season. As the twins head out to California, they face an exciting but also anxious time in Chula Vista. But if they make it, they might be playing alongside some of their heroes, the stars without whom the Women's Soccer League would never have been born.
Perfect Drive is our best rewards program.
After just four rentals, our customers get everything from golf clubs to ski goggles.
Even spa treatment.
What if we also throw in a personal trainer?
Hi, I'm Todd.
Hi.
Today we're going to work glutes. Walnut.
Personal trainer seems a bit much.
Yeah.
The rewards program is perfect.
Yeah. People love free stuff.
On now, women's soccer comes of age on Inspired to Win on the Discovery Channel.
I used to think the casino business was easy. You open your doors and people give you their money. Then Hoyle comes out with this casino game. Now we're working long hours just to keep up.
Ow! What?
Hoyle gives them real casino action, real blackjack, roulette, poker, and slots. What's worse, they get so good, they could clean us out.
Sweet dreams.
It upsets me.
Royal Casino, the best-selling casino game. Buy it on PC, Game Boy Color, and more. Rated E for everyone.
Reactor 3 at critical mass.
Core temperature still rising.
Close the flow channels. Activate the hydrogen recombiners.
Meltdown.
Do it.
In 10 seconds.
Oh! Are you new to the team?
Well, actually, I'm with the tour group. But I did stay at a Holiday Inn Express last night.
Stay smart. Stay at a Holiday Inn Express.
You know, a chief executive is only as effective as the people around him. And so tonight, I see this as an honor for all our people. Their intelligence, professionalism, and their voice.
Stop rushing to make shipping cutoffs.
Did I make it?
Yeah, you got later pickups now.
Introducing FedEx Extra Hour Service. Ship up to 3 hours later and still get it there overnight.
You got a shrimp thing happening in your pocket.
On Now, Women's Soccer Comes of Age on Inspired to Win. Next, how safe are you at home on Justice Files? Tonight on the Discovery Channel. Get wired for the Discovery Channel Adventure Race. 5 days of pure physical pain. Scattered over New Zealand's most punishing terrain. Scientifically monitored racers hook you to the competition like never before. 24-hour biofeedback, thermal imaging, calorie depleted and sleep deprived. Experience the world's most grueling adventure race, beat by beat. The Discovery Channel Adventure Race, Sunday, April 22nd at 9 Eastern and Pacific, on the Discovery Channel.
It's 6:30 p.m. in San Jose.
Welcome home.
And Brandi Chastain, World Cup champion and one of the brightest stars of the new Women's Soccer League, is back home after many days on the road.
Now, what's your one line that you have going tomorrow?
Take that, jive turkey.
Tonight, Chastain is practicing with her husband. Not her game, but her lines for a Bud Light beer commercial.
Yeah, almost like you lived in the
70s. You grew up in the 70s, so tell me.
Oh, yeah.
How do you say it? Tell me, give me the real...
Take that, you jive turkey.
I'm going to have to work on that one, I think. But you...
You got to extend the jive.
Jive?
Jive turkey.
Jive turkey.
That will be a crack up.
And the other one, Julie gets to say, yeah, we're bad.
You're just a bad.
Yeah, we're bad. We're real bad.
They couldn't be this bad if they weren't so good at soccer, a game that Americans cared nothing about until they came along. Their success has led to a new era in women's sports, on and off the field.
So Brandi, lean back a little bit.
On the soccer field, they are as serious and intense as can be. In front of the cameras, let's just say it's a whole other ball game.
Go, girl. Oh, it's fun. I mean, you can be goofy.
Back in the heat.
I mean, we don't do anything active. We look like we're in uniforms and we pretend like we're kicking balls, but it's all make-believe. But, because it's so different, that's why I think it's fun.
Margaret.
It may be fun for Foudy, but it is serious business for Anheuser-Busch.
They're the stars. They're why we're here, Sean. They're going to sell the beer.
All right, baby.
They sell the beer and a whole lot more.
They play soccer by day.
Two of the best-known faces of women's soccer.
They are the baddest mamas on the planet.
Take that job, turkey.
Chastain and Foudy use the precious airtime to promote the game they love and the league they have long dreamed of.
You chicks are bad.
Yeah, we're bad.
Real bad.
For superstars like Julie Foudy, Brandi Chastain, and Mia Hamm, the league is the fruit of over a decade of hard work, which began in 1991 when they brought home their first World Cup.
Let me just say that it's great to join you in honoring a group of women who reflect a favorite American pastime. It's known as winning. And leave it to an American women's team to win our first World Soccer Championship ever. I hope the men start catching up.
But the team's big victory was buried in the headlines, and the public took no notice. And so playing soccer professionally remained a distant dream.
We played the World Cup in, I think, November.
And I received a card. And inside was a check for $500. And I thought, oh, yes! I thought I was rich.
All of that changed in the next few years. The women won game after game, including the gold in the 1996 Olympics. Each victory garnered more popularity.
Our big push of the national team is you've got to market the heck out of this team. You know, it's a gold mine of personalities and role models. And kids will respond to this. They just don't know about it.
By World Cup 1999, everybody knew about the team. When the final game was held at the Rose Bowl, to everyone's amazement, the 90,000-seat arena was sold out, and TV ratings went through the roof.
Who's your favorite player?
It was special because the former edifices reserved for football were now being filled for women.
We have to be in style here.
There were thousands and thousands of little girls with mom and dad. And from that point on, it became larger than life. The soccer team was exploding this cultural myth that nothing is bigger than football. Well, soccer was bigger than football.
The final in World Cup 1999 was a tight match between the Americans and the Chinese.
It was a little bit of Cold War pizzazz, China versus the U.S., the Reds versus the American democracy.
During the final minutes of the match, American goalkeeper Brianna Scurry made a heroic save.
I honestly believe that no matter where she kicked the ball, I would have saved it. When she was walking up to the spot, she had her head down and her shoulders slumped. I looked at her and I was like, that's the one right there.
It was up to Chastain to finish the job.
I don't even really remember seeing anything, but I remember talking to myself saying, don't look at the goalkeeper, don't look at the goalkeeper. And then the whistle blew.
Chastain marked the moment with a provocative gesture that irked some and thrilled many others. She took off her jersey and waved it at the crowd.
People ask me all the time, tell us what you were thinking and why did you do it? And I don't know. I have no idea why that moment happened.
Ecstatic Chastain, in her jog bra on her knees at the Rose Bowl, made the magazine covers.
I've run into now 9 and 10 and 12-year-old girls who just run around in their jog bras and they wave their shirts. And I have fathers saying, you made me go out and buy 3 jog bras for my daughter.
Nicknamed Ms. Hollywood by her teammates, Chastain's provocative move sealed the team's place in the national limelight.
And there was a return to heroism that wasn't tainted by arrogance and how much money they were going to make at the end of it. Everything you wanted a hero to be, the soccer players turned out to be. And it was kind of that Disney-like happy ending that everybody likes to see in sport and drama.
The victory of the national team captured the imagination of Americans of all ages.
Back up, please. Back up.
The legendary Mia Hamm, who has scored more goals than any other player, male or female, in international competition, is regularly mobbed by admiring fans.
My friend Bob, yeah, he's going to go out of his mind when he sees this.
These gorgeous gold winners had what it takes to get the sponsors' attention. Companies like Nike were among the first to bankroll the team, and ads featuring the players hit the airwaves.
How'd it go?
He had to drill. I got 2 fillings.
Then I will have 2 fillings.
But Mia, I just examined your teeth. They're perfect.
I will have 2 fillings. I will have 2 fillings. I will have 2 fillings.
Next, the women hit the talk show circuit.
The U.S. national women's soccer team captured the World Cup national attention and hearts in abundance this summer.
Critics argued that Team USA was just a group of pretty faces, a point of which the team's defenders are well aware.
I don't think there's any question that our culture still demands attractive women as a requirement for an endorsement contract. But the female athlete now is standing up and saying, guess what? I can be anything I want to be as long as I choose it and not the product who I'm working for. Let me define myself. Don't you dare define me.
Who cares what they look like? If you stink and you can't play and you're not winning, you know, entertainment only lasts so long with looks, you know. It's, you got to be good. You got to know how to play and win, and we've been successful. That's what brings people back.
Success has also meant creating a whole new image of the female athlete, not the lesser, but the equal sex. Bold enough to go neck and neck with the ultimate male athletic icon.
You had enough?
I just got started.
I think the Gatorade commercials with Mia and Michael Jordan were pretty extraordinary. Taking an icon like Michael and creating this icon Mia and putting them together was brave and it was memorable. It was a pretty unbelievable step for advertisers.
For the first time, feminine beauty was flexing muscles.
Women can be as strong as men. They have competitive spirits. It's okay to be strong. It's okay to have an opinion. It's okay to stand up and voice that opinion.
You can be feminine, you can be a mom, you can be a wife, you can do it all and still go after what you love.
The national team's success stood as an unprecedented breakthrough for women.
I can't tell you how many women from the ages of 40 to 75 that have hugged me and said, God bless you for putting women on the map. And I, in turn, look to them and I say, thank you for all the battles you had to do before I even came along. Because those were really the most difficult ones. They broke the ground.
After all of their match-winning goals, these women still strive for a higher goal. To give every girl in America a shot at their game by having a league of their own.
When I was growing up, I didn't have a women's team to look to. I watched men's soccer, and I loved every minute of it. I was in awe of them. I think the greatest thing that can come out of this is the building and creating relationships between young boys and young girls. That one day, it won't matter if you're a boy or a girl on the football field or on the kickball field or in Little League.
There's a girl being born in America. And somebody will tell her she is beautiful. And somebody will tell her she is strong. There's a girl being born in America. And someone will give her a doll. And someone will give her a ball. And then someone will give her a chance.
Come on, let's go.
Sweetie, I'm sorry. I can't stand the line. We're going to miss our flight.
Well, I wish you could go, too.
Yes, I know how much you love Walt Disney World, but we can't take you with us this time.
Well, for one thing, I don't think your wife and children would appreciate it.
Okay.
If you think a Walt Disney World vacation isn't the same without the kids, you're absolutely right. Call 1-407-W-DISNEY and make the dream come true.
Your doctor about Nasonex with moisturizing glycerin, taken once a day for nasal allergy relief due to pollens, molds, dust, and pets, day or night. Sleep on it. Side effects were generally mild and included headache, viral infection, sore throat, nosebleeds, and coughing. Nasonex. Fewer sneezes, fewer worries.
On now, women's soccer comes of age, uninspired to win, on the Discovery Channel.
So now you have this difficult decision. You can choose a makeup that just hides lines and wrinkles for a day, or one that actually fights them over time. Now there's a remarkable makeup that blends away wrinkles today for a luminous finish, while its exclusive vitaminizing formula works within skin to actually help fight 7 signs of aging over time. So what's it going to be? Partial effects from your makeup, or new total effects from Olay? If only all decisions were so difficult. Proven to be a remarkable makeup for younger looking skin.
Thank you.
need a new roof. How about cedar shingles?
Those won't last.
Or asphalt. Very cheap.
This looks nice. Metal roofing.
Metal roofing? That's not for you.
We'll take the cheap ones.
Excellent. Looks like pork for dinner.
Your home safe. With metal roofing, log on. You could win a roof.
Meet Tian Tian and Mei Shang, Washington's new power couple, as Animal Planet gives you the exclusive story of the giant panda's journey from China to the Smithsonian National Zoo. Watch Meet the Pandas, a global television event, April 22nd at 9 p.m. You can only catch this exclusive planet-wide premiere on Animal Planet.
After Inspired to Win, how safe are you at home on justice files, then roller coasters, swimming pools, and shopping? Go on the inside of the world's largest mall.
Way to go. Saba cats are moving to a cyber beat. Saba living, Saba playing cool and sweet. There's even Saba IRS to save a little Saba stress.
Get your refund in half the time. Ask your tax preparer to use IRS e-file or use your own computer. Even sign electronically.
40 million people already know e-file.
Soccer League is not just for today's players, it's for tomorrow's. In March, the U.S. Youth Soccer Association held a tournament in Las Vegas for the best young players ages 15 to 17 years old. Olympic and World Cup champions Joy Fawcett and Shannon McMillan took time out from their busy schedules to visit. Besides drumming up some new fans for the league, Joy and Shannon were there to answer questions.
What sacrifices did you make to get to this level?
Sacrifices? A lot along the way. In high school, I missed my proms, you know, missed going out on Friday nights with friends and stuff, because we always had that early game Saturday. But it's definitely worth it. I mean, I'm living a dream by playing soccer for a living, so it's definitely worth it. And with all good things, you have to make sacrifices.
Well, my goal was always to be the best and to go as far as I could. And now that we've started this professionally, well, that's a dream come true for us. You know, we needed a place to play outside of college. Once you get out of college, there was nowhere to go. You'd have to go back home and train on your own. So I think this league is just awesome.
Good question. And it's exciting for us because when we were that age, we didn't have female soccer players to look up to. Finally, there's the national team, there's the Olympics, the World Cup, there's the WUSA. There's so much out there, and these kids are just so excited. They want to be a part of it so badly, and it's great for us to be able to step back and be like, there it is, you know. If you have that dream, go after it. It's possible. Make it happen.
Who's your favorite player?
All over the country now, thousands of young girls are being inspired to win.
Danielle's side, she might have to track all the way back. Brenna will stay high, or vice versa. If Brenna's tracking all the way back, Danielle will just stay high and be the target, and we'll play off of that. You've got to step in hard. You can't let them play the ball. Hey, you understand? You've got to step in hard.
Usually, it's the parents who pass their love for a sport on to their kids. But in this generational switch, it's the kids, for the most part, who are teaching their parents about soccer.
I think that the children have brought the parents to the sport. I think that their interest in the sport has brought their parents along, because if their parents see that they're interested in something, that's going to make them more and more interested in it. It's just growing constantly.
Parents Kim and Max Steeler never played soccer in school, but they became avid fans when their daughter Brenna started playing when she was six. Since then, the obsession with soccer has become a family affair.
It's an outing, which is kind of cool. You know, people say, well, that's all you do. Well, that's what we do, but we do something together, so it's fun. It's madness. We're addicted to it. I mean, it's just now become a very big part of our life, not only with Brenna, but with the boys. They're coming along and doing pretty respectable at it. But Brenna has just been, you know, the one that really pushed us.
Want to see Myra?
Brenna is 12 now, and her room is a treasure trove of soccerbilia.
This is a studio box of the studio Golden Goals that came out with it after the women had won the World Cup.
Instead of Britney Spears or Buffy, Brenna's idols are Mia Hamm and Brandi Chastain.
My ball is signed by Mia Hamm. This ball is signed by Brandi Chastain. And this is a certificate of authenticity and a picture of her signing it. I think it's important that we have role models such as Mia Hamm because it gives other people, like younger players, to have a goal to reach and to want to be like that person.
Guys, what did you guys do?
Brenna also has the support and enthusiasm of her soccer mom, Kim Steeler.
I had to do this thing for Mrs. Smith in science.
She picks her daughter up every day after school and takes her to practice.
She trains twice a week with a trainer. It's amazing how she just clicks. You know, you kind of go along and you're working on it and you're working on it. And then she'd go to a game and she'd do something and I would just be amazed. And I'd say, yes. It's clicking. It's going.
After school, she spends 5 afternoons a week at soccer practice or with her trainer, Brian Sentowski.
Clean. Good.
Brian played on the U.S. national soccer team.
Lower. You're standing up right
now. He sees young girls aspiring to the same goals,
in explosive position, always,
including possibly playing on a professional team one day.
Soccer is definitely at an all-time interest high here in the United States. People are starting to know about the game, understand the game, and starting to really get a grasp of what it's about. It gives them something to kind of dream about, set some goals to try and make it to that league.
Following the lead of her role models, Brenna's goal now is to try and qualify for the Olympic Development Program, which trains the best young soccer players in the country. And she's willing to put in the hard work and make the sacrifices to get there.
I started to get serious about it when I was in fifth or sixth grade when I was playing with Madison. I talked about it with my parents and we decided, like, I wanted to go to the highest level and I had to make a lot of sacrifices.
But that hurt.
Like going to parties and things like that.
It hurt a lot.
Yeah.
Friday night, the entire Steeler family heads out to Brenna's soccer game at the local armory in West Orange, New Jersey.
It's definitely a big commitment, but we kind of view it as they're only going to be here for another 10 years. And, you know, would I like to have all the rooms painted? Would I like to have all the yard work done, everything perfect? Oh, yeah, the answer is absolutely, I'd love it. But there's a trade-off. There are only so many hours in a day. So we figure we'd rather do this part upright. Thanks, and when they're gone, then the place will be pristine and all the blades of grass will be going in the same direction. And
I think it's totally cool how they're really hyped up about it and stuff and they're totally into it. Cool to know that they're in there, like, rooting for me.
When the game starts, it's a win-win situation for the entire family, especially when Brenna scores a goal.
When I win the game, it's, like, a really good feeling, especially if I've scored in that game or assisted the goal that was scored in the game. I think it'd be really cool to be the top in the world. And then if I won the World Cup, that'd be really cool. It's like I'm on the best team in the world.
If Brenna continues to advance, one day she may get to play in the Women's Professional Soccer League.
Think fast, because right
Right now, Suzuki, the fastest-growing Japanese auto company in America, is offering special introductory 0.9% APR financing on the all-new Suzuki XL7, the first seven-passenger SUV in its class. It's got a third row of seats and available rear air conditioning, features you won't find in the Ford Escape or Mazda Tribute. Act fast, because the Suzuki XL7s are going, well, fast. For the Suzuki dealer nearest you, call 1-877-MY-SUZUKI or visit us online at suzuki.com.
You're watching the Discovery Channel.
You know, a chief executive is only as effective as the people around him. And so tonight, I see this as an honor for all our people. Their intelligence, professionalism, and their voice.
Want to stop rushing to make shipping cutoffs?
Yeah, you got later pickups now.
Introducing FedEx Extra Hour Service. Ship up to 3 hours later and still get it there overnight.
You got a shrimp thing happening in your pocket.
Insurance company that believes the most important thing they cover is the risk you didn't think of? Without question, the St. Paul.
On now, women's soccer comes of age, uninspired to win, on the Discovery Channel. People Magazine says it's something you've never seen on a holy card.
It's much more likely to be an accurate reflection.
Sunday, forensic science and high-tech imagery reveal what could have been the face of Jesus. Newsweek, the Associated Press, Entertainment Weekly. It's what everyone's been talking about. See for yourself. Jesus, the complete story. Sunday, 8 Eastern and Pacific. Only on the Discovery Channel. After Inspired to Win, how safe are you at home on Justice Files, then roller coasters, swimming pools, and shopping? Go on the inside of the world's largest mall.
It's 3 weeks before the WUSA kicks off its inaugural season. At the preseason training camp in Chula Vista, California, athletes are training, teams are competing, rookies are making a last-ditch effort to make the final roster. And tension is high as executives, coaches, and players scramble to pull it all together before launch.
Carol 10, you gotta go. You just went in. You gotta go and help her.
I'm very excited. I think this is something that we've dreamt about. It's been a long time coming.
We've been training for almost 3 weeks now. We've been doing 2 days, a couple hours in the morning, you know, hour and a half in the evening, and lifting weights whenever we can in between and afterwards. Now we're trying to taper in and focus more on the fine-tuning parts of the game.
Yeah, end up, come on.
Up, 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 up.
Come on.
We've had our ups and our downs, and I think anybody who thought it would go smoothly would be foolish. And we've dealt with some things that, you know, have, I think, caused us to test our patience.
Tony DiCicco has flown in from New York.